The triumph of Ulanor. The Emperor's forces have driven back and defeated the forces of the biggest orc warlord in the sector. But the time comes for the Emperor to return to Terra, to complete a secret project. To this end, he decides to appoint a War Master, to lead the armies of the Imperium in his name. Initially, he considers Horus, but decides that it might drive a wedge between him and his brothers, for it was known that Horus was the most beloved of the Emperor's sons. He decides to pick someone else, a brother whom the others would respect and honour, a man who would become a leader amongst leaders. The Emperor chooses the angel Sanguinius. Sanguinius, shocked at his decision, respectfully declines. He argues that he should not be War Master, for he believes himself too emotional to be able to handle the stresses of commanding every fighting force in his father's Imperium. Sanguinius suggests Dorne, for Dorne was a great warrior, stoic, noble, even if he did seem emotionless at times. Dorne had the shoulders that could bear the weight of an empire. The Emperor considers Sanguinius' request before agreeing, and Dorne takes up the title of War Master. Near the eastern fringes, close to the realm of Ultramar, the Ultramarines finish their compliance of the small system of Kutas, driving to extinction a violent Xenos race known as the Qatari. It was while on the main world of the system, Kutas Prime, that the Ultramarines forces discovered an ancient artifact known as a Black Oculus. The Qatari seemed almost desperate to protect this vast relic of black stone. It was engraved with what looked like some kind of Xenos creatures dancing and cavorting around the hieroglyphic script. Against his legion's wishes, Gilliman, as a man who loved ancient history, felt compelled to study the artifact. The Ultramarines' attempts to remove the Oculus were in vain. It seemed embedded into the very bedrock of the planet, and were not moved by crane nor by melter charge. He became obsessed with the Oculus, much to his first captain's chagrin. Soon, he began to hear voices from the artifact that no one else could. They were speaking directly to him. The artifact was speaking directly to him. A faint glow emerged from what appeared to be an engraving of an outstretched hand. Upon touching it, he felt as if his soul had left its mortal frame. He was in a realm of glowing iridescent colours, and could make out the form of two figures coalesce within the chaotic vortex. One avian, one feminine. These beings told Gilliman everything. The truth of his father, of his origin, and the source of his powers. They showed him that gods were real, and the imperial truth was a lie. The creatures also told Gilliman that he and his brothers would become extinct following the Great Crusade, the same fate as the Emperor's previous Thunder Warriors, and that a new force will replace them. Gilliman felt his soul return to his body and fell to his knees, and began to weep. Everything he knew was a lie. A shard of the Oculus broke off and landed in front of him, in the shape of an 8-pointed star. Upon returning to Macragge, Gilliman would learn that his close friend Rogel Dorn had been appointed as the new War Master. Dorn was one of Gilliman's dauntless few, the brothers that Gilliman himself could trust with anything. He needed to inform his brother that their father had lied to them about everything. He would keep the star he recovered close to him, and ordered his artisans to forge a new set of armor for him. With the 8-pointed star imposed over his father's Aquila. Deep within the Davin system, War Master Rogel Dorn received word from his brother, Rebute Gilliman. Gilliman requested that Dorn come and see him on the world of Kutas Prime. Dorn initially declined, for he was too focused on fighting their father's wars. He had sent the Blood Angels to the Vespar system to liberate the human populations from their Xenos dictators, and had ordered Fulgrim of the Emperor's Children and Ferris Manus of the Iron Hands to apprehend their brother, Conrad Kurz, whose atrocities needed investigating, and if need be, answering for. Gilliman ordered one of his captains, Varus Caspian, to travel to Dorne's flagship, the Phalanx, entrusting him with the Shard of the Oculus. Caspian was ordered to deliver the Shard to him at any cost, for Dorne needed to know the truth about everything. In the Vespar system, Sanguinius and the Blood Angels would fight numerous battles on the worlds that had fallen under the thrall of an unknown Xenos species. They were tall, lethe creatures with large leathery wings, like demons of legend. The Blood Angels could find no traces of humanity, though, except for empty hab blocks and bleached bones. The Blood Angels would fight for weeks against the Xenos, and, eventually, Sanguinius and his children forced the remaining Xenos warriors left upon the final world into what appeared to be a temple. Upon entering the temple, there was no sign of the Xenos. Sanguinius and his men became awestruck at the sight before them. The walls of the temple were beautifully adorned, painted with murals and decorated with vast jewels and gold leaf. Vast pillars were erected around the temple, each one with an item of jewelry made from gold, silver, platinum, and various other unknown yet beautiful metals. Enthralled by the sheer beauty, Sanguinius and his men were distracted long enough for the Xenos to launch their final, desperate assault. The Xenos were wiped out, but not before taking a heavy toll on the Astartes. Sanguinius ignored the fallen corpses of his men, and approached what appeared to be a mirror for how reflective its surface was. As he took hold of it, he could feel its inviting warmth through his armored fingers. He instructed his men to take the remaining items back to their ship, while the temple itself, like all places of worship throughout the Great Crusade, was to be destroyed. The jewelry would rest in the ship's reliquary as trophies. It later transpired, thanks to information garnered from Blood Angel's patrol sweeping the system, hunting down any possible Xenos survivors, that the human populations were rounded up like cattle, and either butchered, devoured, or processed into what could only be described as some kind of narcotic. In the days that followed, Sanguinius found himself spending more and more time within this flagship's reliquary, admiring his new trophies, donning a necklace here and a ring there. He smiled to himself as he found himself finding joy at how beautiful he looked with them. Slowly, he found his senses were becoming heightened whilst wearing the jewelry from the temple. His reflexes were seemingly faster in the training cages, and blows he suffered in sparring matches gave him no pain, but joy. He began to act as if he was addicted. But he couldn't help it, because it gave the angel so much pleasure. The forces of the Emperor's Children and the Iron Hands landed upon the world of the Night Lord's latest compliance. The sight that befell them was horrifying. Rows upon rows of makeshift crucifixes with butchered, mutilated corpses impaled upon them. The Primarchs Fulgrim and Ferris Manus eventually found their brother, Conrad Kurz, Primarch of the Night Lord's Legion, executing those soldiers who had surrendered in the war. Fulgrim and Ferris were appalled by Conrad's actions, and demanded to know why Kurz would do such a thing. Kurz answered that the only way to keep peace throughout the Imperium was through fear, to prevent uprisings, to make an example of all who would stand against them, for the purpose of the Great Crusade was to conquer. Fulgrim and Ferris disagreed. They argued that their role was to bring illumination and truth to the masses, and if the people were treated with compassion, they would serve loyally. Kurz called his brothers weaklings and naive. Fulgrim and Ferris called Kurz a cynical fool. In their father's name, Fulgrim and Ferris went to apprehend the Night Lord, but Kurz would not go quietly. After a brutal and bloody fistfight, Fulgrim and Ferris bound Comrade Kurz in heavy black iron shackles and chains. with the intent of bringing him back to Terra to stand trial for his actions. Varus Caspian was granted permission to dock with the Phalanx and requested a private audience with Rogul Dorn. The Ultramarine explained everything that Gilliman had discovered to the Warmaster. Rogul Dorn was outraged at the accusations that their father would betray him and his brothers. In his anger, Dorn let loose a punch so hard to Caspian's face that his helmet would shatter, leaving bloody scars across his face. The shard of the oculus that Caspian held fell from his grip and landed on the floor with a gentle clinking sound. Dorn would have Caspian taken away and locked within the ship's brig, and would decide on a punishment for the Ultramarine later. Rogul Dorn picked up the stone shard in the shape of an 8-pointed star and examined it. Feeling a gentle, almost imperceptible surge of energy emanate from it. He then demanded the ship's captain and navigator to set course for the Kutus system. Gilliman would answer for his accusations. Dorn would see to it personally. Gilliman would spend more time on Kutus Prime, studying the artifact more and more. He would learn through ancient texts that the Black Oculus was known to the Eldar race as the gateway to the gods. He became more and more obsessed, performing daily pilgrimages to the realm where he met the godly bringers of truth and enlightenment, his growing fanaticism and fervor spreading throughout his legion slowly, like a cancer. He was soon informed that the entire Imperial Fist's legion was en route to the system, with the intention of making Gilliman explain his actions and heretical accusations. Gilliman smiled as his brother made his way to the planet, and Gilliman's forces stood ready to greet them, his honor guard also wearing the symbol of the 8-pointed star upon their breast and pauldrons. The Emperor of Mankind was becoming increasingly unhappy with his son, Magnus the Red, and his legion, the Thousand Sons. The legion had, despite the dangers it presented and the warnings the Emperor himself had given them, continued their studies of the warp and sorcery. The Emperor soon couldn't withstand such repeated disobedience, and thus held the Council of Nicaea. Despite the arguments of Magnus and his legion, the Emperor forbade the use of sorcery throughout the legions, to the point of demanding the Librarius of each legion to be disbanded. All Astartes with psychic potential were to return to rank and file duties within their legions. Despite Magnus's protests, the Emperor decreed that due to his son's disobedience, a unit of the Legio Custodes, the personal bodyguards of the Emperor himself, were to return with Magnus to Prospero to ensure that his decree was followed to the letter. He knew Magnus was a glutton for knowledge, who would risk anything to acquire it. This way, at least, the Emperor would know that his son would do what was told of him. Rogul Dorn's forces landed upon the world of Kutus Prime, anger boiling throughout his veins. Gilliman bade for the Warmaster to heed his words and would show him the Black Oculus. He requested for his brother to place his hand upon the structure so that he may be enlightened. Dorn hesitated, fearing some kind of deception, but reluctantly agreed to do so. Like his brother before him, Rogul Dorn felt his soul enter the realm of the gods, and unlike Gilliman, was not greeted by two, but five figures which formed from the very swirling chaos that was before them. As they did with Gilliman, they told Dorn the origins of the Emperor and the source of his otherworldly powers. But additionally, they told Dorn that only he, as Warmaster of Mankind, could save the human race from extinction. The Emperor, they told him, would not only destroy the Astartes after the conquest of the galaxy, but slowly would destroy all of humanity, so that he could ascend to godhood. They explained that they simply wished to be left alone, and thus would do anything to assist the War Master in his goals, for their goals aligned. If the Emperor's plan to become a god were to fail, Dorn would be made a hero of the Imperium. No, not a hero. A saint. Humanity would enter a new golden age, guided by the fist of Rogel Dorn. Rogel Dorn initially denied such a thing could be possible, but the godly beings filled Rogel's mind with visions of the past, of the present, and what must have been the future. Or at least, a future. He was shown a future where humanity would become paranoid and violent, locked in a dark age of mythology and eternal suffering, where, in the grim darkness of the far future, there was only war. He was shown visions of ghostly beings wreathed in flame and bone, a twisted mockery of the proud and noble Legio Astartes. He saw his beloved brother Sanguinius dead before his father's feet. But Dorn could stop this nightmare, and the godly beings would help for a small yet eternal price. Dorn couldn't believe what he was seeing. It couldn't be real. But everything deep within his soul told him that not only was it real, but Dorn, and only Dorn, could prevent the damnation of the human race. When Dorn's soul returned to his body, he turned to his brother, Rabute Gilliman, and demanded that he would summon the brothers they could trust with such sensitive information. Gilliman was ordered to summon the Dauntless Few. Despite the edict passed at Nicaea, not all the legions disbanded their Librarius. A few defied the Emperor in their own ways, most notably the Space Wolves, who claimed that the power of their rune priests comes from the very homeworld of Fenris and not the Warp, and the White Scars, who, due to their cultural ties to the homeworld of Jagoras and its people, kept their librarians, the Stormseers, in an active officer role. Jagatai Khan was not pleased by the Emperor's decree, but agreed to try and at least limit the active combat role of the Stormseers by utilizing their talents in a similar manner to their legion's navigators and astropaths. While en route to Terra, Fulgrim visited Conrad Kurz in his cell. It was there that Kurz told his brother of the constant mental barrages he suffered of visions of the future, of how his soul was tortured by his own psychic ability, and how he felt his mind was slowly fracturing. Fulgrim took pity on his brother and agreed to be his brother's confidant. Fulgrim was told by Conrad that he did what he did, not through sickness of mind or finding a perverse pleasure in spreading fear, but that he did what he did for peace and justice. Ferris Menus and the Iron Hands would be ordered by the War Master, Rogel Dorn, to head to the Kutus system, leaving the Emperor's Children Legion alone to escort the Night Lord's Primarch back to Terra to stand trial. Ferris and Fulgrim would exchange their sorrowful farewells, and the two brothers vowed to meet again to fight alongside one another once more. The Regent of Terra, Malkador the Sigilite, had travelled to the world of the Wordbearer's latest compliance, Kerr, accompanied by the warriors of the Lunar Wolves Legion, a unit led by Captain Garviel Loken. The Primarch of the Wordbearers, Lorgar Aurelian, greeted the Regent of Terra warmly, like a man greeting a beloved uncle in the capital city of Monarchia. Malkador spoke, with a voice of sorrowful anger. The Emperor was unhappy with the slow speed of the Wordbearers bringing worlds to compliance. Malkador had come to personally ascertain why. Lorgar explained that the reason his legion was taking such a long time was due to him personally making sure that freshly compliant worlds were stable and self-sustaining, fully functional and accepting of the Emperor's divinity before moving on to the next world. Malkador was disappointed. He once again repeated to the Primarch that the purpose of the Great Crusade was to bring the truth of knowledge and reason to humanity, not to replace false gods with a new one. Lorgar argued that the Emperor, as an object of worship, would bring the people into line, a figurehead for humanity to gather around, to become stronger as a species, a society, and an imperium. Malkador shook his head sadly. He warned the Primarch to tear down the churches and cathedrals erected in the name of the Emperor, for he would oppose such actions. Lorgar pleaded, but Malkador was set fast. He, however, agreed to not inform the Emperor of his son's actions. In return for the Wordbearers returning to the Great Crusade with righteous fervor. As the Sigilite left the world, Lorgar put himself at a crossroads. He loved his father, worshipped him as a living god. His heart was torn, for his father would reject being a subject of religious devotion, despite deserving to be one. He ordered his legion to make preparations to leave for the next battle zone, but the churches of the Emperor would remain intact. This way, at least, the souls of the people on the worlds made compliant by the Wordbearers would be safe from the horrors that haunt the darkness. For the Emperor protects. Within orbit of the world of Cutis Prime, the Imperial Fist's flagship, the Phalanx, floated in the void. Rogaldorn, the Warmaster, awaited with Rabute Gilliman for the arrival of their closest and most trustworthy of brothers, a dauntless few. The Wolf King, Leman Russ, Primarch of the Space Wolves, was the first to arrive, followed by the Lord of the Blood Angels, Sanguinius, and finally they were joined by the Lord of Iron, Ferus Manus of the Iron Hands. Rogaldorn began to explain what he had learned from Gilliman, every last detail. The Primarchs were shocked, appalled, disgusted. Russ boiled with deep anger and blood-red fury. Ferus Manus felt a deep sorrow gnawing at his very soul. Sanguinius, however, seemed unfazed, too busy focusing on his own preternatural beauty. Gilliman smiled to himself, recognizing the cuneiform script that adorned the angel's new accessories as being identical to the runes from the Black Oculus. Leman Russ, in his rage, demanded proof of such accusations, or that he would tear the War Master's head from his very shoulders with his bare hands. Gilliman would offer it to him in time. Ferus Manus then raised an important issue. There would be those within their legions who may not follow their orders should they decide to rebel against their father. Not to mention the brothers who would turn against them. If they committed to this action, it would lead to the biggest and bloodiest war in humanity's history. Rogaldorn simply stated thus, "Were not the lives of the Emperor's own sons worth anything?
Did they not deserve a life after the Long Crusade? Or were they to be discarded? If their father was removed from power, then they could rule the Imperium, guiding humanity to a better future. A ruling council made up from the Primarchs, with Rogel Dorn at their head, watching over and protecting their fragile human subjects, instead of the so-called God Emperor devouring their very essence to become all-powerful. Rogel Dorn stated that this rebellion, no, revolution, was for the greater good. Reluctantly, the dauntless few agreed. Gilliman would show them the black oculus, which in turn would give them their own visions. Plans would soon be made to remove those from their legions who could prove troublesome, potential defectors to their father's side. Rogel Dorn had an answer. A system that proved troublesome and aggressive to a warlike degree, in keeping its own sovereignty and independence from the Imperium. The Istvan system. Meanwhile, on the worlds of Prospero and Chagoras, the Primarchs Magnus the Red and Jagatai Khan felt that something was terribly, terribly wrong. Upon the world of Aeolith, a cabal of various senile species hatched a plan. They dispatched one of their agents, a human perpetual named John Grammaticus, to track down the enigmatic Primarch Alpharis Omegon of the Alpha Legion. His mission was to bring the Primarch to Aeolith so that they could enlist his aid to help with events that would affect every single sentient species within the galaxy. John Grammaticus tracked down the Alpha Legion to the world of Nerth, and through subtlety and deception, found his way to the Primarch to seek his audience. Alpharius, John Grammaticus said, was the only being who could prevent the destruction of the entire galaxy. Alpharius, either out of trust or curiosity, agreed to travel to Aeolith with his legion once Nerth was made compliant. The Dauntless Few made preparations to purge the potential loyalists from their legions. They would send those men to the surface of Istvan III. Then, the world would be virus-bombed, making all life upon the planet extinct. The only potential loyalist who would not be dispatched to the world would be the Ultramarine Sergeant Aeonid Thiel, who, along with his squad, known for insubordination, was under the direct command of Varus Caspian on the frigate Ve Victus. Gilliman had a soft spot for Thiel and hoped to be able to sway the sergeant to his side one way or another. If not, Caspian had orders to terminate him and his men. Rogel Dorn meditated within his chambers. The shard of the oculus, it transpired, had allowed Dorn to converse with the godly beings within the warp. The gods praised Dorn for the first steps he would take. They showed him visions of the war to come, of fire, blood, screaming, and dying. Rogel Dorn would not win this war with the legions he had at his disposal alone. He would need to grow his forces. He would need to bring more of his brothers into the fold. As his soul floated within the ether, the godly beings faded from his view, and a bright light glowed from the corner of his eye, banishing the darkness
and almost blinding the War Master. As Rogodorn turned to face it, he saw an apparition, a figure of pure white light, a spectral horse made from lightning. The horse galloped toward him, and, with the sound of a thunderclap, shifted its form into one that Dorn knew. Jagatai Khan. Khan demanded answers from his brother, why he would betray his father and his people. Rogel Dorn explained what he had learned, but Jagatai Khan refused to believe him. Khan warned Dorn that his actions would damn the souls of not only him, but also his brothers, and the very men who would follow him. The godly beings began to coalesce again, and the bright light began to slowly flicker and die. Jagatai Khan begged his brother to listen to him. Do not go through with this. Do not betray your father, your family. And finally, the light that was Khan's astral projection was snuffed out. On Jagoras, Jagatai Khan awoke from his trance, surrounded by his storm seers. He demanded for the astropaths to send warning to Terra immediately, but they could not. Warp storms had erupted throughout the Imperium. Astropathic messages would be next to impossible to send or receive. The Khan clenched his fists and, in his frustration, put his hand through a wall. There was only one chance he had left to warn his father in time. He demanded all of the storm seers gather and prepare for the inevitable. The bombardment of Istvan III begins. Thousands upon thousands of warheads containing the Life Eater virus detonate all over the planet. The virus penetrates the power armor of the Astartes on the world, and soon all biological matter on the world, the people, animals, and plants, are turned into puddles of decaying sludge, releasing copious amounts of flammable gas. The Phalanx, flagship of the Imperial Fists, fires a single lance shot into the atmosphere, igniting a tremendous firestorm that would sweep and sterilize the world within a matter of minutes. Upon the frigate, the Vae Victus, Aeonid Thiel of the Ultramarines watched in horror. This was wrong. Their brothers were on that world. Thiel and his men staged a mutiny upon the vessel, resulting in a savage gun battle upon it between his forces and the traitorous forces under the command of Varus Caspian. Through a stroke of luck, an explosion breached the hull of the ship, the resulting vacuum dragging many of the traitorous marines out into the icy void. Thiel and his men quickly capitalized on the situation and took control of the Vae Victus, making a daring escape. The traitorous ships nearby attempted to stop the Vae Victus from escaping, but failed as the ship made an uncontrolled warp jump into the unknown. Gilliman raged upon finding out. Their plans were about to be scuppered. Rogel Dorn contacted Gilliman and informed him that they had a larger problem to deal with. Jagatai Khan, through the psychic powers of his legion Stormseers, had discovered the plans of the Dauntless Few. Luckily for them at least, the amount of warp storms had made astropathic messages next to impossible to send. But if the Khan knew, then the most powerful psychic amongst the legions, Magnus the Red, would surely know as well. Rogel Dorn ordered Leman Russ and the Space Wolves Legion to make their way to Prospero and either bring Magnus into the fold or destroy him and remove a potential threat. The War Master then ordered Gilliman to send emissaries to more of their brothers. They needed more allies if they were to win this war. Rogal Dorn and Ferris Manus would land their forces and construct a base of operations to prepare for a potential upcoming conflict upon the world of Istvan V. Upon Prospero's surface, Magnus roared in fury. His sensitive mind could feel the disturbances upon the skin of the warp. But thanks to the custodians who were to accompany him at all times to reinforce his father's edict, he was nearly powerless to act. He knew a storm was coming, and ordered his second-in-command, the former chief librarian, Azek Araman, to evacuate the civilian populace off-world, and have Prospero's spire guard reinforce the defences around Tisca. Magnus demanded to the custodians to allow him to clarify the disturbances he felt, but was denied time and time again. On Chagoras, the Stormseers gathered. Hundreds of powerful psychers gathered for this one single purpose. They would allow Jagatai Khan to create an astral projection, and thus allow their Primarch to ride the currents of the Imperium to warn the Emperor directly. As his soul rushed through time and space, he found his path blocked. He raged as he tried to breach the psychic barrier, but he could not. Even with all the powers of his Legion Stormseers augmenting his own preternatural abilities, he could not breach this wall. A voice in his mind offered to grant him a way to break through the barrier, and without hesitation, Khan agreed, not knowing the future ramifications of his actions. It's true what they say. The path to ruin and damnation is paved with the best of intentions.
Upon the Blood Angel's flagship, the Red Tear, Sanguinius spent more and more time indulging in ever more increasingly hedonistic practices, be it in the indulging of fine food, pungent perfume, or other sensory stimuli. The practices began to spread amongst the rest of the Blood Angel's Legion, slowly but immeasurably. A creeping corruption, slowly changing their outlooks, beliefs, and urges. The angels started to crave more and more extreme sensations. The once beautiful corridors of the ship slowly degraded as the Legion serfs were forced to decorate the ship's interior with increasingly bright and garish colours and patterns, an affront to anyone with the gift of sight, let alone a sense of taste. The Legion serfs would notice that when Sanguinius was alone, he would often talk to himself before bursting into fits of sadistic laughter. The voices that emerged from his lips were not only his, but seemingly he had the voice of a seductive woman and the deep baritone of something else, something darker altogether. Those mortals who dared look upon the once beautiful face of the Lord of Angels would begin to cower in fear. His eyes. They were not his eyes anymore. What once shined an icy blue, like the purest and most perfect sapphires ever carved by an expert jeweler, had become a deep violet that seemingly swirled with other shifting colors. Sanguinius sat upon his throne in his chamber, and began to think to himself about what other greater pleasures could he
and his son's example.
Food and wine were fine enough for mortal men, but for Astartes, they required more. Much, much more. He ordered his legion apothecaries to concoct stimulants and narcotics for the legionnaires, based upon the formulas that were used by the Xenos his legion had recently purged. But to do that, they would need pure human tissue. And with that, Sanguinius had every legion serf and remembrancer, who was deemed as non-vital crew, rounded up and slaughtered like livestock. Sanguinius would smile as he ordered the legion's tech marines to make modifications to their power armor, to pump and recycle this substance on a continuous basis, making every Astartes within the legion a slave to self-indulgence. Upon the world of Aelith, the Primarchs of the Alpha Legion, Alpharius and his twin, Omegon, met with the alien Cabal. The Cabal explained to them that their brothers had rebelled and fallen under the sway of the Chaos Gods, and that two possible outcomes would emerge from the conflict. If the Emperor's forces won, then Chaos would be pushed back, but eventually return, stronger than before corrupting, enslaving, and wiping out all life in the galaxy after 10,000 years of human suffering. But if Rogel Dorn and his forces won, Chaos would be triumphant for a time, but eventually, the human species will be forced into a rapid spiral of self-conflict and extinction so great that the Chaos Gods would never recover. So while damning humanity, all other races will be spared. Alpharius and Omegon's actions would affect the galaxy. The Xenos pleaded with the Primarchs to side with Rogel Dorn. Alpharius clenched his fists and turned to his twin before calmly stating that he was loyal to his father, his emperor, and would not fall for a pathetic Xenos trick. He ordered his troops to open fire. The heavy rattle of gunfire and explosions of bolt rounds lasted but a few minutes, but long enough to ensure that all but the human perpetuals lay dead or dying upon the stony ground. They apprehended the perpetuals, and Alpharius gathered his troops and ordered them to join up with the loyalists for the Emperor. As the Vae Victus traveled through the warp, Eonid Theel ordered the ship's navigators to try and bring them back to the Sol system. They needed to inform the Emperor of the treachery of his sons at any cost. They traveled for what could have been days, weeks, maybe even years. Hard to tell given the instabilities of warp travel, thanks to the warp storms making the ethereal currents treacherous. Soon, they found that their ship's Geller field was failing, and were forced to re-emerge into real space, low on fuel, supplies, and morale. Eonid Theel thought he and his men would die stranded in some uncharted wilderness of the deep void. A proximity alarm began to ring throughout the ship as a large vessel was fast approaching them. Their scanners were broken, damaged from the unstable journey through warp space,
and the loyalists were unaware if this new ship was friend or foe. An energy surge began to grow in size upon the bridge of the Vae Victus, and Aeonid Thiel and his men hurriedly readied their weapons. Whoever this ship belonged to, they were teleporting aboard. A blinding flash of green light and arcing lightning heralded the arrival of 8 towering figures in heavy bone and green-coloured Tartarus pattern Terminator armour. The Terminators raised their weaponry in response to the Ultramarines, who held their bolters ready. A single figure emerged from amongst the Terminators, towering over all of them, carrying a massive scythe in his hand. The Death Lord Mortarion, Primarch of the Death Guard. Mortarion asked who was in charge of this damaged vessel, and offered to escort them back to the nearest naval base to refuel and resupply. Theo stated that he needed to make way for Terra, for he had dire news of the utmost urgency for the Emperor. When Mortarion asked why he couldn't tell his Primarch of this dread news, Theo requested to speak to Mortarion in private, upon his flagship, the Endurance. Mortarion laughed upon hearing the news Theo brought, assuming it was some kind of joke. When Theo assured him it was all true, Mortarion's mood soured. The Ultramarine was surely lying. Upon looking up the service record of Aeonid Thiel, he noticed the sergeant's long and colourful history of insubordination. Mortarion demanded why he shouldn't simply execute him for treachery and desertion of his legion right there and then. A voice came from behind Mortarion stating simply, because the Ultramarine was telling the truth. As the Lord of the Death Guard turned around, he was surprised to see his brother, the Primarch Alpharius Omegon. Alpharius confirmed to Mortarion that Aeonid Thiel was telling the truth, and that they needed to inform their father, the Emperor of Mankind. As Jagatai Khan's astral projection breached the psychic barrier, he found himself before his father, seeing his soul as a blinding golden light. He found himself unable to speak, but the Emperor saw his son's image and became angry. Jagatai Khan had inadvertently destroyed an important artifact, one important to the future of the Imperium and of Terra itself. As Jagatai Khan found his soul banished back to his body, awakening from his trance, the Emperor shook his head sadly. His son had defied his edict, and thus needed to be punished. He ordered his Praetorian, Horus Lupercal, and the Lunar Wolves to travel to Jagoras and arrest Jagatai Khan. Within the Prospero system, the Space Wolves Legion prepared for battle. While the Rogal Dawn wished to bring Magnus into the fold, Leman Russ despised the Primarch of the Thousand Suns. He viewed his legion as weak, cowardly, and unworthy to be called warriors. The Space Wolf Armada began to systematically destroy the orbital defense platforms orbiting the world of Prospero, sending burning wreckage to drift lifelessly in the icy void of space. Prospero would not survive this day, and Leman Russ smiled at the prospect of not only humiliating, but destroying his sorcerer's brother. On Prospero's surface, alarms were soon raised. The planet was under attack. Magnus the Red ordered for his legion to prepare for battle, and to ready the various sorcerous cults to utilize them in the upcoming conflict. Despite the custodians on the world ordering Magnus that he was forbidden to do so, Magnus responded by saying that if they were to survive this battle, he would accept any form of punishment his father would sentence him. The skies would rain fire as hundreds upon hundreds of drop pods and Thunderhawk gunships began to descend from orbit. Planetary defense lasers fired repeatedly, filling the burning sky with flashes of blue light. And while destroying many, there were simply far too many to stop them all. With thunderous impacts, the drop pods crashed into the planet, and the frenzied warriors of the Space Wolves Legion emerged, charging towards their cousins like frothing berserkers of legend. The thousand sons of the Pyre and Pavoni cults began to open fire with jets of psychic fire and crackling arcs of warp lightning, while the members of the Raptora launched bombardments of large boulders and heavy debris in a desperate attempt to hold back the grey tide of savagery. Devastator Marines and the artillery of the planet's Spire Guard fired continuously, to the point of their weapons glowing red hot and overheating. Lehman Russ led his men from the front lines, butchering the mortal Spire Guard soldiers and the Thousand Sons' own assault troops with relative ease. But he began to rage. His men were unable to reach the cowardly sorcerers. As Russ continued to kill and cleave and carve his way through the ranks of the Loyalists, the sky itself began to turn blood red, and a fine mist began to creep along the cracked ground. Magnus the Red himself joined the battle, surrounded by his Terminator-clad bodyguards of the Scarab Occult and the Custodes close behind. The Wolf King howled in bloody fury, swearing an oath he would personally take his brother's head and present it to the War Master. Magnus the Red conjured up a massive storm of ethereal lightning across the battlefield, managing to keep the wolves at bay for a time. Lehman Russ himself tried to push forward, feeling the lightning burning his flesh and armor and howling in rage at Magnus's cowardice. He then felt a voice speak to him in his mind, offering him the power to slay the sorcerer in return for blood. And with a thought, the pact was made. Lehman Russ howled in torturous pain, a howl so blood-curdling that it was a sound no living being could ever make. He felt his bones lengthen and stretch, his armor buckle and split, and his skull shifted and elongated as the Primarch grew in size. A huge pair of leathery wings emerged from his spine, covered in the tattered remains of human flesh. The Space Wolves closest to him also began to change, their bodies shifting and mutating into roaring, feral, bestial creatures. The creature that was Lehman Russ flexed his newly acquired wings, raised his lupine head to the sky, and roared. The battle for Prospero raged. Lehman Russ had been blessed by the Blood God and had ascended to a demon prince, the Red Wolf of Khorne. The beast gripped in its taloned hands perverted versions of his former weapons, a massive axe and long serrated sword, both made from blackened iron and wreathed in warp fire the color of blood. Russ rushed towards his former brother, Magnus the Red, hacking at him with his demonic blades, the unholy weaponry clashing against Magnus's own Kopesh blade, sending vast amounts of sparks from the metal like petals of light. Magnus tried to bring his immense psychic might to bear against the beast that used to be Lehman Russ, but his powers had no effect. The thick brass collar around the demon's neck nullifying all psychic energy around him. Magnus, with his mind's eye, saw this, and with a surge of adrenaline, pushed the creature back before lunging forward, clasping his hands around the collar. His hands were punctured by the thick metal spikes protruding from it, blood flowing like a river from his hands. But using his preternatural strength, ripped the collar from Russ's neck, shattering the metal, and blasted him back with immense psychic force. Magnus fell to one knee as Liam and Russ staggered back to his feet, and with the feral wolf and creatures bounding towards him. Magnus had only one thing left to do. Using the last of his great psychic might, he teleported most of his forces onto a lone battle barge that survived the void battle with the Space Wolf's fleet, leaving the Primarch alone with the Custodes against the entire Space Wolf's legion, who were baying for blood. Magnus rose up and gripped his Kopesh tightly. He turned to the golden-clad warriors beside him and let out a single loud cry before charging towards the beast that was no longer his brother. For the Emperor. The Phalanx received a transmission from the Space Wolf's Legion. It was a short transmission, displaying the severed heads of Magnus the Red and the Custodes who had died alongside him in battle. Liam and Russ then appeared on the screen, displaying his new demonic wolf-like form, smiling with a predator's grin. Rogel Dorn nodded and smiled, recognizing the form Russ now took as similar to one of the godly beings from the warp. Magnus was one of the most dangerous wild cards in this upcoming conflict, and with his removal, the Warmaster believed he and his forces now held the advantage. He received another transmission from his brother, Rabute Gilliman. The Lord of Ultramar smiled and nodded. Everything was going to plan, and more of their brothers had seen the light of their cause. Rogel Dorn nodded and told his brother to prepare them for war. The Emperor, saddened by the damage suffered to the Webway and to the Golden Throne, knew that a powerful Psyker must now sit upon it and use their abilities to prevent a warp tear from engulfing all of Terra. He tried to send a psychic probe to his son, Magnus the Red. But then, for the first time in hundreds of years, felt fear. He could no longer feel his son's presence, his once burning light snuffed out like a dying candle. The Emperor knew something was afoot, and ordered the recall of the Iron Warriors Legion to Terra. The world needed to be reinforced for the upcoming conflict. Little did he know how soon said conflict would come.
The Lunar Wolves fleet made haste for Chagoras, the homeworld of the White Scars Legion. Horus sent transmission after transmission, begging his shadowy brother to not resist and to avoid pointless bloodshed. Jagatai Khan protested that by coming all this way to arrest him, they were wasting valuable time. Rogel Dorn and the others had betrayed them, and would soon move against Terra itself. Horus pleaded with Jagatai Khan once more to stand down and be arrested for his treachery in defying their father's edict. Jagatai Khan grew angry at the accusations and having his warnings go unheeded, screaming that he was no traitor. But if Horus was looking for a battle, then Jagatai Khan and the White Scars would give him one. With great regret, Horus ordered the fleet to commence planetary assault and to capture the White Scars Primarch by force. Perturabo was surprised by his legion's sudden recall to Terra. As he made his way to the Imperial Palace, he was greeted by the Regent of Terra, Malkador the Sigilite, and Constantine Valdor,
the Captain General of the Legio Custodes. Malkador briefed Perturabo on the situation at hand. The Emperor foresaw a great apocalyptic battle that would in time reach the cradle of humanity, Holy Terror itself. Perturabo and his legion were tasked to reinforce the defense of Terra, and in turn, the Imperial Palace. Perturabo would erect numerous weapons platforms upon both the planet's surface and within its orbit, and would begin adding numerous layers and layers of adamantium and rockcrete armor plating to the walls of the palace, despoiling in the beautiful architecture of its gold and ivory walls to a mishmash of practical, darkened metal adorned with spines and gun batteries. Malkador was saddened to see the beauty of the palace become tarnished so, but was practical enough a man to understand its necessity. The Iron Warriors would also begin to carve miles upon miles of trenches in all directions around the palace, setting up vast killing fields that hopefully, to Malkador, would never need to be used. A short time after, the Death Guard flagship, the Endurance, arrived in orbit of Holy Terra. As the ship was sent a transmission directly from the Imperial Palace, from none other than Malkador himself, Alpharis Omegon and Aeonid Theo relayed the truth that they had discovered. Alpharis was ordered to gather his legion and head to the Istvan system, in order to suppress this insurrection at the hands of Rogal Dorn. To this end, he would receive aid from the full force of the Emperor's children, the Night Lords, the Salamanders, the Dark Angels, and the Raven Guard, who in turn would be ordered to abandon what missions they had to counter this more immediate threat to the Imperium. Rogal Dorn's rebellion will be crushed, and he and his followers will be destroyed, and all trace of their existence wiped from history, like those in times long ago attempted their own petty power plays for their own self-interests. Upon the bridge of the Emperor's Children flagship, the pride of the Emperor, Fulgrim collapsed into his throne in sheer disbelief. He had learned that not only had some of his brothers turned against the Emperor, but one of those traitors was his closest friend of all, Ferris Manus of the Iron Hands. He retreated to his quarters and, away from the watching eyes of his men and crew, broke down and openly wept, tears streaming down his face. He reached for a framed picture, made from paper taken from some of the last trees on Terra itself, and delicately ran his fingers over the image. The image was of Fulgrim and Ferris embracing in a brotherly hug, laughing about some events long forgotten, immortalized by one of the Legion's remembrances. Now, Fulgrim was faced with the prospect of having to kill his most beloved brother and friend. Conrad Kurz, the Night Haunter, would be pardoned for his actions, given his role in suppressing this insurrection, and thus was moved from the brig of Fulgrim's ship. Kurz entered Fulgrim's chambers and placed his hand upon his brother's shoulder, a small attempt to comfort him. He informed Fulgrim that he would return to his ship the nightfall. Fulgrim bade him to stay a while and asked if Kurz's power of foresight could see the resolution of this rebellion. Kurz turned to leave without saying a word, but Fulgrim grabbed the Lord of Night and pinned him to the wall with surprising force. Fulgrim demanded that his brother tell him what would happen in this war. Comrade Kurz grinned his vampiric grin and told Fulgrim that loyalist and traitor alike will die screaming in unimaginable suffering. The armored fist will break the walls of gold, and that the Imperium will be shattered into a form unrecognizable by their father. Truth will be lost and replaced with lies. Fulgrim asks what fate will become of him in Conrad's visions. Conrad Kurz looked him straight in the eye and said one word. Death. And with that, the Lord of Night left. Fulgrim once more picked up the picture before clenching his fist so tight that his grip cracked the glass and threw the frame at the wall, causing it to splinter and tear. His mood shifted. Gone was his heartache and sorrow, and in its place grew a burning fire. A fire of rage and hatred. Dorn, Gilliman, Russ, and Sanguinius will all pay for their treachery. But as for Ferris Manus, Fulgrim swore he would bring his brother to justice, and that he would be the judge, jury, and executioner. Meanwhile, aboard the Divinitas Lex, Lorgar, unaware of the great heresy Dorn and his followers were perpetrating, received a transmission. An ultramarine had come with a message from his Primarch, Rebute Gilliman, to be personally delivered to the Lord of the Wordbearers. As the ultramarine met with Lorgar in his chambers, he handed Lorgar a small black glassy shard in the shape of an 8-pointed star. Vulcan, the Lord of Fire, Primarch of the Salamanders, was beloved by most of his brothers and by the people of the worlds he brought into compliance. He was seen as a gentle giant who would unleash his fury to defend those he deeply cared for. It's always funny, though, to find that the kindest and gentlest souls can be driven to acts of such unimaginable cruelty. The Salamander's Legion had just finished the cleansing of the world of Kalek, driving to extinction the native Xenos population, powerful reptilian hominids that towered over the average Astartes. It transpired that the Kalekid had developed an advanced philosophy concerning their disgust of war, and had restricted such armed combat in such a way that it was kept contained within vast slaughterhouses. These slaughterhouses were massive in size, several kilometers in diameter. Having ascertained why the Kalekid had assembled within their slaughterhouses, the Salamanders prepared to face them in honorable combat. However, Vulcan received word that the Emperor requested his immediate aid. Vulcan took the opportunity to refuse to engage the Kalekid within their marked out fields of battle, and simply had the species destroyed en masse from afar. When Vulcan returned to his flagship, the flame wrought. He was surprised to see a party of ultramarines awaiting his return. The leader of this group of ultramarines, Freitas Augustin, claimed to have urgent news for the Primarch. Vulcan said that it would have to wait, for he had been summoned by the Emperor himself. Augustin stated that this was far more important. Vulcan scoffed at the thought. What could possibly be more important than his father? Freitas Augustin pressed for Vulcan to humor him, holding a small black stone in his hand, presenting it to the Primarch. Vulcan looked at the small trinket and flung it back at the ultramarine, growling in annoyance to not waste his valuable time. Augustin and his men, in response, drew their weapons and opened fire. A violent gun battle erupted upon the bridge of the ship. Vulcan smashed Augustine's head clean from his shoulders, with a single blow from his hammer, Dawnbringer, before crushing another Ultramarine's ribcage to dust. A lucky blast from a plasma gun caught Vulcan point-blank in the eye, causing the Primarch to stagger and fall to the deck with a deafening thud. Soon, all the Ultramarines lay dead on the bridge, along with several salamanders and servitors who were caught in the crossfire. Shortly after, the First Captain, Artellus Numion, and members of the Pyre Guard stormed the bridge to find the scene of the carnage. Numion hurriedly rushed to his Primarch's side and shook his head in despair. Vulcan was bleeding heavily from the head, where his flesh had been blasted to the bare bone, and his one remaining eye was closed. The puddle of blood flowed all over the metal deck until it touched a small black shard that Vulcan had dismissed but a few moments earlier, which gave out a single, gentle pulse. Vulcan found his soul drifting in the ether, a large spectral creature in the form of a vast black and white dragon, spoke to him. It told Vulcan that he must travel to Istvan V. His brother Rogal Dorn and the Dauntless Few needed his aid, for the good of humanity and the Imperium. The shard pulsed once more, and Vulcan sat upright, and his flesh began to slowly knit back together. Artellus Numion and the Pyre Guard viewed it as a miracle and began to stomp and chant, "Vulcan lives! Vulcan lives!" Lorgar took the shard of black glassy stone into his hand and felt its energy pulsate from it. He received a series of flashes in his mind's eye of howling monstrosities and beings that were as divine as they were dangerous. Reflexively, he dropped the shard onto the floor of his chambers with a gentle clinking sound. He recognized the aura that emanated from it as being identical to those that existed within vast monuments that were erected on his homeworld of Colchis during his youth, of the Covenant of Colchis and the Old Faith, of the Old Gods, Khan, Tzen, Slanat, and Arag. Lorgar slowly turned his gaze to the Ultramarine, Arius Cordos, who had handed the shard to him, demanding to know where he acquired it. He then for the first time noticed the rune of the eight-pointed star, painted over his father's Imperial Aquila. Arius Cordos smiled and relayed the story of how Lorgar's brother, Ribute Kilimon, had discovered the black oculus on Kutus Prime, and was shown visions of the future and of the truth by none other than gods. "Lorgar was right," Cordos said. "The gods are real, and the Emperor, in his actions, were not only harming them, but his actions would damn humanity and the Astartes to extinction." Lorgar grew angry, but calmly stated that there is no god but the Emperor of Mankind, and that the actions of the Ultramarines were that of dangerous heretics consorting with devils, not gods. Cordos shook his head and said that the Five would bring a new golden age to humanity, which would end in the death of the Emperor for his crimes against his sons, his people, and the very gods themselves, and that those who did not join this revolution would also fall to eternal damnation. Lorgar's own fanaticism boiled through his veins, and he plunged his fist with immense force through Cordos' ribcage and crushed his two hearts with his armored fingers. He let the corpse fall to the floor with a sickly wet thunk, and calmly walked over to his bedside table and picked up an old ceremonial knife. Gilliman was called to the docking bay of his flagship. He had been informed that Arius Cordos' ship had returned. Expecting good news, he went down to personally receive it. What greeted him shocked and angered him. The ship contained the crucified body of Arius Cordos, his face covered in a series of deep scores and cuts, in a crude representation of the Imperial Aquila. Around his neck hung a sign, with words painted in blood, that said, Ave Imperator Heretic. Gilliman slammed his gauntleted fist into the ship's hull in anger. Lorgar would pay for this insolence. Rogal Dorn sat upon his throne on board his flagship, the Phalanx, and pondered. He had agents sent out to those brothers whom he believed could side with him, but there were others who would be considered too wild in the central conflict. He decided to take advantage of his position of War Master, and if those wildcards were still unaware of this insurrection of his, then he would simply send them on crusades as far away as possible, in preparation of his forces' assault on Holy Terra. A proximity alarm began to ring throughout the Phalanx. A vast fleet was approaching them, and fast. As the ship's crews worked in overdrive to make prepared weapon systems and raising shields, the Phalanx received a transmission from the fleet's flagship, identifying itself as the Invincible Reason. Rogal Dorn stormed onto the bridge of the Phalanx and demanded to know how such a large fleet could have arrived so close to them without detection. When none of the bridge crew answered, he demanded that the transmission be put through. As he looked at the monitor, he watched it flicker and stabilize into the image of his brother, Lion L. Johnson, the Lord of Caliban and Primarch of the Dark Angels Legion. There was an uncomfortable silence between the two for an indeterminate number of heartbeats, before finally the Lion spoke. The Lion asked the War Master why he was doing this, but his tone was not one of anger or fury, but rather one of morbid curiosity, which surprised Dorn. The two would begin to talk at length about Rogal Dorn's plan and the visions he had received. Lionel Johnson was admittedly impressed by the sheer size of Rogal Dorn's force that he already acquired, and he warned the War Master that 5 other legions were en route to put a stop to this heresy. Dorn asked him why he would give such advance warning and knowledge to him. The Lion stated that he knew of Dorn's attempted coup and of their father's own righteous fury. Ever the strategist, he was carefully weighing up the situation before deciding to choose with whom to place his bets for victory. Lionel Johnson decided to side with Rogal Dorn for something in return. When Dorn became the new Emperor, he would crown the Lion as the new War Master. Rogal Dorn considered it for a moment before agreeing. And with that, the Dark Angel's fleet disengaged and headed to the outer limits of the Istvan system, ready to maintain their illusion of loyalty to the Emperor. The Alpha Legion fleet soon re-entered material space, the first to arrive outside of the Istvan system, and was soon joined by the fleets of the Emperor's children and the Night Lords. They saw the Dark Angel's fleet had already arrived, and patiently waited for the arrival of the Raven Guard and Salamander's legions before discussing battle plans. Alpharius, however, decided to dispatch small cells of agents to the other fleet's flagships to allow them to spy upon his brothers. The current situation had made him more paranoid than usual, and gave his spies their orders to watch for signs of treachery and, if necessary, either terminate the target or try to overload the warp cores of the traitors' flagships. One way or another, any traitors would be suitably dealt with. The Lunar Wolves began to descend upon Jagoras. Thousands of Thunderhawk and Stormbird gunships landed upon the world, and Horus and his men marched, intending to arrest Jagatai Khan. The Lunar Wolves soon found themselves encircled by dozens of war bikes, land speeders, and jet bikes, the traditional intimidation tactic of the White Scars. The Lunar Wolves raised their weapons in response, but Horus ordered that no one was to open fire. He walked on ahead, alone, from the rest of his forces, and once more called out to Jagatai Khan. Jagatai Khan rode towards him on his custom war bike and revved its engine repeatedly. He demanded Horus to leave his world and leave him be, for there are more important things at stake. Horus said with a sad voice that he cannot leave without bringing Khan back either to Terra in chains or in a coffin. For Jagatai was a traitor in their father's eyes and needed to be punished for his actions. Jagatai Khan was enraged, his whole body trembling with anger. He dismounted his bike and drew his talwar blade, activating its arcing blue energy field, taking up a combat stance and standing his ground. He told his brother that he was no traitor, but he would not be arrested, and if Horus wanted to bring him back to Terra, it would be over his cold, dead body. Horus gripped his mace, Worldbreaker, in his hands, and thumbed the activation rune, causing the weapon to crackle into life. The whole world seemingly fell silent before the two brothers charged at one another, followed by the legions under their respective command. As the last remaining battle barge from the Battle of Prospero raced through the warp, the newly appointed Lord of the Thousand Suns, Azek Ahriman, hoped that they would encounter some of their brothers. When they re-entered real space for the Tech Marines and the Mechanicum Adepts to carry out urgent repairs, Ahriman's prayers were seemingly answered. A trio of light cruisers made course to intercept them, both painted in ruby red with the heraldry of the Thousand Suns Legion. Azek Ahriman opened a transmission to the lead vessel and was relieved to see his brother of the Corvidae cult, Reviol Arvidar. Arvidar inquired as to what Azek Ahriman was doing so far from Prospero. Ahriman, with a heart filled with sadness and regret, informed Arvidar of the fate of Prospero and of the heroic sacrifice of Magnus the Red against the traitorous forces of the Space Wolves, and of the change of Leman Russ into a new bestial form. Reviol Arvidar had always been a skeptical soul, but seeing Ahriman so far from Prospero and away from his Primarch's side convinced him it was true. While he thought Ahriman to be too shadowy for his own tastes, one thing Ahriman was not was a liar. When Ahriman asked about the mission that Reviol Arvidar and his men were undertaking, Arvidar smiled. They had discovered a piece of ancient technology on a nearby moon, a standard template constructor which could construct the legendary and highly dangerous Men of Iron.
A few days prior to the Battle of Istvan V, Corvus Corax, the Primarch of the Raven Guard, sat in his chamber opposite the Ultramarines Envoy. He listened to him talking about Dorne's great plan to turn the Imperium into something greater than it is now. He fell into two minds about the situation, being a revolutionary in his own right when he liberated his home from the tyrants who enslaved his people. He found it hard to believe that the Emperor would become such a cruel dictator, but all the signs were there. His great crusade to bring all the worlds to one banner, under one figurehead? Corax could see both sides of the coin. He thanked the Ultramarine for his message, and said he would inform his brother of his decision soon. He asked one of his captains
Solara Ann for his take on the situation. Solara stated that he believed that such open rebellion was foolish, but at the same time, he believed that his father couldn't let all of humanity fall under an iron thumb if what the Ultramarine said was true. Korax was racked by indecision, but having received word from Terra itself to undertake in stopping this rebellion, he knew he would have to reach a decision, and soon. Upon the surface of Istvan V, Rogor Dorn himself landed to inspect the fortifications for the upcoming battle. Ferris Manus of the Iron Hands had personally taken charge of the defences and greeted his brother with a clenched fist to the chest in a military salute. Miles upon miles of weapons batteries and artillery had been established, along with trenches and tank traps. Ferris Manus informed the War Master that everything was close to readiness. He then inquired about their brothers. Gilliman would take command of the fleet and charge of the naval battle. Leman Russ, in his new bestial form, along with his legion, had yet to return from Prospero, while Sanguinius and his kin were preoccupied with stimulating themselves for ever-increasing heights of pleasure, despite Dorn's wishes. While a bunch of pleasure-induced maniacs would be useful fodder in the battlefield, without Russ to join them, and Gilliman commanding the naval battle in orbit, it would be an extremely bloody conflict. Ferris Manus gripped his Thunderhammer, Forgebreaker, and looked at it sadly. The hammer was constructed by his beloved friend Fulgrim. He hoped he wouldn't have to use it, and that Fulgrim would see sense and join them. Rogor Dorn reminded Ferris Manus that they were at war, and there would be no place for sentimentality at this time. As the Salamanders and Raven Guard fleets approached the Istvan system, Alpharius activated a mass transmission to the legions. He began to describe his battle plan, where the Alpha Legion would make a series of flanking maneuvers, while the Emperor's children and Night Lords committed to a forward assault. The Raven Guard and Salamanders would remain in reserve to replace those who had run out of ammunition or were unable to continue fighting while reinforcing their defences. Fulgrim gripped his power sword, Fireblade, in his hand and drew it. He thumbed the activation rune, and the blade became wreathed in fire. As he gazed into it, he remembered back to the words that Conrad Kurz had spoke to him. Death. Horus and Jagatai Khan clashed on the plains of Jagoras, striking at and blocking each other with their weapons, like knights from ancient legend. The Khan was known for his skill with a blade, his disdain of acrobatics and fancy ornate moves that many of his brothers used, preferring on relying on the simpler, brutish yet skillfully targeted strikes. The two locked their weapons again and stared each other down. Horus said that this wasn't personal, he was merely following their father's orders. Jagatai Khan spat back that because of Horus's actions, their father may soon no longer live. This comment enraged Horus, who pushed Jagatai back, causing him to kick up a large cloud of dust and loose soil. Jagatai used his lightning speed to rain blow after blow on Horus with his talwar, until Horus blocked the blade with his bladed talon and crushed it, sending arcs of light in all directions as the field generator within the blade shorted out. He swung his mace, Worldbreaker, and sent Jagatai flying back several feet into the dirt. Horus slowly stepped towards him, ignoring the battle raging around them between the Lunar Wolves and the White Scars. he lowered his mace to his brother and demanded that the Khan yielded. Jagatai Khan groaned in pain. The blow from Worldbreaker had cracked his ribcage. He glared up at Horus with disdain in his eyes, too proud to ever surrender. A bolt of warp lightning caught Horus off guard, causing him to stagger as the Storm Seers approached. Bolt after bolt impacted Horus's cataphracty plate, sending sparks and searing paint and decorative fur off with the pungent smell of burnt metal. Horus gritted his teeth and braced himself, slowly pushing his way forward as the Psykers continued to attack him with their supernatural abilities. A Rhino APC rolled up, and a combat squad of White Scars, along with the apothecary Altan Nohai, disembarked. Altan Nohai tended to his Primarch, examining the state of his injuries. The White Scars Astartes began to open fire on Horus, the rounds from their bolters impacting his armor. But still the massive Primarch pushed forward, his face twisted with fury and determination. Nohai informed the Chief Stormseer, Tagutai Yusegi, that the Khan needed immediate medical attention. The White Scars needed to flee Chagoras. Yusegi gave the order, and the White Scars began to pull back and retreat, desperate to reach their transports. As Horus raged at his brother's cowardice for not fighting until the end like a true warrior, he turned to his first captain, Ezekiel Abaddon. Abaddon was told to call a retreat. The Lunar Wars would leave Chagoras, and in lieu of killing or apprehending the traitor, Horus would declare the world to be subject to exterminatus via planetary bombardment. As the Lunar Wars retreated to orbit, the fleet began to rain lance fire down upon the world, until the very planet's core detonated, a bright flash of light scattering billions of tons of debris and rock out into the lifeless void. Horus watched the destruction of his brother's world and hung his head low. Jagatai Khan was a traitor, and his cowardice and deception had doomed his world and his people. Horus lamented the loss, but his brother's treason justified his actions.
Lorgar and his legion mobilized for the Ultramar system. He knew that what Gilliman was dabbling in was incredibly dangerous, and Lorgar vowed to prevent such a cancer from spreading throughout his father's Imperium. However, Lorgar knew that purifying the 500 worlds of Ultramar would be a long and dangerous task, especially when dealing with a legion as large as the Ultramarines. However, either through sheer blind luck, or perhaps the God Emperor's divination, Lorgar did find a loyal brother who would aid him in this quest. The Red Angel, Angron, the Primarch of the World Eaters Legion. The World Bearers encountered the World Eaters near the world of Neo-Geddon, who had just recently conducted a purge of a dangerous alien species known as the Tyrellians. Lorgar invited Angron to his flagship, the Divinitas Lex, to explain his proposal to his violent brother. Angron initially scoffed at the news that Gilliman and his legion had been tainted by the foul beings of the warp, refusing to believe in such superstitious nonsense. But Lorgar began to explain to the Gladiator King that Gilliman's rebellion lacked honor, and by cavorting with demonic entities, was a sign of a weakling. Gilliman and his followers needed to be purged. Angron's face began to twitch at Lorgar's words. Truly, he never liked Gilliman, with his bureaucracy and political maneuverings. Gilliman was supposed to be a warrior, and now had turned into a religious fanatic. Angron began to laugh, thinking that out of all his brothers, that Lorgar would have been the one to have found God. Angron and Lorgar made a pact to purge the filth from Ultramar, on the condition that when the time comes,
Angron gets the first opportunity to kill his treacherous brother. Reluctantly, Lorgar agreed. He was wise enough to know that his legion alone didn't have the manpower nor weaponry to take on the 500 worlds alone. Angron returned to his flagship, the Conqueror, and ordered his ship's captain, Lotara Sarin, to set course for Ultramar. In truth, Angron began to feel excited, giddy even. The butcher's nails in his skull lessened their pain for a brief moment of respite, and Angron drank in the knowledge that soon he and his men would finally get a battle worth their time and truly worthy of their martial prowess. As the combined fleet entered Ultramar space, the Wordbearers and Worldeaters were surprised by the seeming lack of defences. No naval vessels patrolled the void, and only the vast orbital weapons platform seemed operational. The Wordbearers took advantage by virus bombing the first few worlds they encountered, stripping them of all life and leaving them dead husks. The World Eaters raged in frustration at not being able to get into honorable melee combat. But their wishes were soon granted, as a small Ultramarines defense fleet set course to intercept them. Angron ordered his troops to board the boarding torpedoes, while the Word Bearers continued to commit exterminatus on the worlds. The World Eaters would board the Ultramarines vessels and slaughter all on board, with Angron himself participating and always where the fighting was at its thickest. As Angron slammed Gorefather and Gorechild, his immense chain axes, into every traitor he could reach, he began to smile. Perhaps the Civil War wouldn't be so bad after all.
The assault on Istvan V began. The combined fleet of the Alpha Legion, Emperor's Children, Salamanders, Raven Guard, Dark Angels, and Night Lord's fleets pushed ahead and disgorged hundreds of thousands of drop pods, thunderhawks, and stormbirds, while their vessels began to open fire on the traitor fleet of the Dauntless Few. Piercing shafts of lance and torpedo fire lit up the void in a vibrant display of color as the two forces clashed against one another. Alpharius was cautiously optimistic, believing that this rebellion of Rogal Dorn would be put down within a few hours. As the drop pods impacted onto the planet, the Astartes within immediately took up overwatch positions, while those Astartes from the Dark Angels and Raven Guard began to fortify the defences brought in by dropships. The Alpha Legion immediately began flanking manoeuvres as the Emperor's Children, led by Fulgrim, Salamanders, led by Vulcan, and the Night Lords, led by Conrad Kurz, began to march across the battlefield. The warriors of the Legio Astartes marching alongside rumbling columns of tanks and armoured transports and the lumbering forms of dreadnoughts. Fulgrim heard a subtle beep of a comm chime within his ear, and was shocked to hear the voice of his once dearest friend, Ferris Manus. Ferris Manus begged Fulgrim to see the light, that their cause was just, and that he did not wish to fight his most beloved friend. Fulgrim's face twisted into a snarl of anger as he spat back in response. How dare he even have the audacity to try and turn Fulgrim traitor? As the Loyalists marched on, they spotted their enemies, the traitor legions. At their head was none other than Ferris Manus. Fulgrim lost himself to sorrow and anger and charged forward ahead of the other Loyalists, powering up his fireblade and hurling himself into battle. He swung his blade in wild, frenzied arcs, severing limbs and heads in his wake, bisecting traitor marines who stood in his path until he finally reached his brother. Ferris's face was one of regret and grief. He begged Fulgrim once more to reconsider.
But Fulgrim howled in anguish at the betrayal he felt from his brother, his closest brother and dearest friend. With vengeance burning in his blood, Fulgrim swung his blade at Ferris Manus with all of his might. Within orbit, Rebute Gilliman oversaw the void battle, and calmly, he contacted the flagships of the Raven Guard and the Dark Angels. He asked if preparations had been completed. The captains on both ships answered that they had, and both fleets slowly began to slink to the rear as the fighting continued, in preparation for their treachery. Upon the Raven Guard flagship, two of the marines on deck opened fire, killing several Raven Guard ship crew and servitors before fleeing the bridge. Gilliman watched the screen in disbelief before clenching his fists and slamming them into the railing of his ship's command lectern, before shouting the name of his brother with unbridled venom. Alpharius!
The Alpha Legion spies ran as fast as they could, desperate to reach the ship's power core. They had discovered that the Raven Guard were traitors, and, per their Primarch's orders, hurried to overload the core and destroy the ship. An alarm began to sound throughout the ship, and Raven Guard Astartes frantically began to search for the spies. Although given that the Alpha Legion spies were clad in the colors and heraldry of the Raven Guard, this would not be an easy task. The Dark Angel's flagship, the Invincible Reason, was placed on high alert. If there were spies on the Raven Guard ships, then surely they would be on the vessels of the Dark Angels as well. Captain Stenius ordered the engineering deck to be put on lockdown, and for the gun servitors on board to be activated. Rebute Gilliman debated informing the War Master, Rogel Dorn, but decided against it. Dorn would be busy commanding the forces on the planet. He did not need this distraction. Gilliman ordered his forces to continue the battle as normal, to focus most of their fire on the Emperor's children, Night Lords, Salamanders, and especially the Alpha Legion. Fulgrim and Ferris Manus locked their weapons, parrying blow after blow as Fulgrim hacked at the Iron Hand's Primarch like a feral beast. Ferris fought only to defend himself against the frenzied blows, never taking advantage of any openings Fulgrim presented. He didn't want to kill Fulgrim, but it was looking like his hand will be forced. Fulgrim managed to knock Ferris Manus to the floor and leapt on top of him, bringing his flame wreath blade down to his brother's throat. Ferris Manus gripped the blade with both hands, letting his hammer, Forgebreaker, fall onto the rocks below them with a metallic clatter. Tears streamed down Fulgrim's face as he lamented what he was forced to do, pushing the blade with all of his might. Ferris could feel the heat of the blade against his neck, and in his desperation, brought one hand up to Fulgrim's face, clasping his fingers around it. He whispered the last words that Fulgrim would ever hear. "I'm sorry." With that, Ferris Manus clenched his metallic hand into a fist of iron, crushing Fulgrim's skull with a sick, wet crack of splintering bone and bloody, pulping meat. Fulgrim's body twitched and spasmed before going limp and lifeless. Ferris Manus rolled the corpse off of him and rose to his knees. He looked down at his blood-slicked hand and for the first time realized the horror of what he had done. But he had no time to weep. The Phoenix Guard of the Emperor's children fast approached, baying for blood and screaming for vengeance. Ferris Manus picked up Forgebreaker in one hand and Fireblade in the other, and with the rest of the Iron Hand's legion behind him, charged into the fray. Meanwhile, on Terra, the Emperor felt a great pain deep within his soul. He felt that another one of his sons had been killed. Their souls no longer felt by his psychic touch. The Emperor swore an oath that day
that when Rogel Dorn's insurrection had been quashed, he would make sure that history would never remember the names of those who turned from his light.
The battle for Istvan V raged. Brother fought against brother, Astartes against Astartes, and Primarch against Primarch. Upon the field of battle, Conrad Kurz, Primarch of the Night Lord's Legion, tore through the ranks of the traitors with his lightning claws, laughing like a maniac at the carnage he wrought as he waded through the battle alongside his bodyguards, the Atramentars. During a brief moment of lucidity, he locked eyes with the arch-traitor himself, Warmaster Rogel Dorn, who was mowing down loyalists left and right with his massive chainsword, Storm's Teeth, along with his huskarls. Kurz bellowed out a challenge to Dorn, but Dorn smirked and wagged his finger, denying him such an opportunity. A piercing scream came from above as Sanguinius swooped down, slashing with the blade and carmine. Sanguinius, like Kurz, was laughing like a maniacal idiot, giddy at the pleasure that battle brought. Kurz leapt upon the winged Primarch as he came in for another run, grabbing hold of his armor, and began to stab him repeatedly with his claws. Sanguinius let out a cry, not one of pain or anguish, but one that sounded of purest ecstasy, as if he was enjoying the pain being inflicted in some perverse way. The Angel of Pleasure struck back with repeated punches to the face, causing Kurz to tumble and plummet to the ground with a hard crunch, kicking up an immense cloud of debris. As Sanguinius landed to inspect his handiwork, the Lord of Night pounced from the dust, slashing wildly with his serrated claws, tearing up the angel's once beautiful wings, the once pristine and pure white, now stained a deep crimson. Sanguinius wailed in pleasurable pain as Kurz leapt upon him once more, pinning the angel to the dirt and raining blow after blow upon him, tearing his once beautiful face open with a series of deep cuts, the steaming blood streaming down his face like a river. Out of the corner of his eye, Sanguinius spotted the approaching Vulcan, who watched his brothers in sheer horror as they tried to kill one another. Conrad Kurz was laughing like a man possessed, enjoying the pain he was inflicting. Sanguinius smiled slightly and called out to his brother. Vulcan, he cried, help me. Vulcan was stunned. His worldview was being called into question. Sanguinius was supposedly a traitor, but Kurz was being nothing more than a sadistic beast. Torture was not the way of a noble warrior. What Kurz was doing was wrong, but Sanguinius had betrayed their father. What was right now? What was wrong? Could he truly remain loyal to the Emperor if those loyal to him were capable of such cruelty? And not only that, but take pleasure from it? Could he follow orders even if they were to do something so wrong? He was always a loyal son who loved his father and his brothers. He detested the sight of his brothers, his family, killing one another. Vulcan stood at a crossroads. Help me, Vulcan. Please, I'm your brother, Sanguinius cried once more, the voice echoing in Vulcan's mind. Vulcan marched closer, gripped his massive hammer, Dawnbringer, in both hands, and swung with all of his might. With a crack, the sound of thunder, Kurz was hurled from Sanguinius and knocked unconscious. Vulcan approached Sanguinius and offered him his hand, helping him to his feet. Sanguinius smiled an almost seductive grin and nodded. Vulcan gave the order, and the salamanders turned on their comrades, gunning down many who were unaware. The Night Lords, Alpha Legion, and Emperor's Children were forced back to their own lines. But here, they could at least find respite and reinforcement at the hands of the Raven Guard and Dark Angels. Couldn't they? as the Alpha Legion spies on board the Raven Guard flagship enter the engineering bay. They hurry to the ship's power core and, accessing the command console, began the lengthy process of overloading it. The tech adepts working nearby demanded they cease what they were doing, but the spies executed all traitors that were nearby. They locked down all entrances to engineering, and soon could hear the repeated banging of the now furious Raven Guard, desperate in their attempts to breach the bulkheads. The console began to flash red as danger showed up on the screen. The cooling system had been deactivated, and the ship's core was slowly reaching critical mass. A warning klaxon began to blare across the speaker systems of the ship, warning of the overload. The bulkheads began to scream with the sound of tearing metal as power fists began to rip their way through. The Raven Guard forces on board finally broke through and stormed in. The Raven Guard demanded for the pair to stop and to reveal who they were. The two spies dropped their weapons and removed their helms, revealing their near identical faces, shaved bald with piercing eyes. They smiled and said in unison, "We are Alpharius." The ship's core then detonated. The vessel was racked with a series of internal explosions before blowing apart from the inside out, sending metal and rockcrete out into the void, the debris ricocheting off the hull of ships in orbit. Having been discovered, the Dark Angels and Raven Guard fleets began to open fire on the Loyalists, destroying many ships in the process. Omegon, the twin Primarch of Alpharius, opened a transmission to his brother and informed him of the situation. Lionel Johnson and Corvus Corax had betrayed them, but the warning came too late. The forces on the surface who had fallen back to their own lines were gunned down by the Dark Angels and Raven Guard. The Loyalist legions were now shattered. Fulgrim was killed. Comrade Kurz was missing. Alpharius, reluctantly, called for a retreat. Those who could escape did. Only a few Thunderhawk gunships made it off-world, carrying individuals and undermanned squads of the Loyalist legions. They retreated to what ships could take them, and those ships that could fled, jumping into the warp and fleeing towards Terra. As the dust settled and the battlefield finally fell silent, Rogel Dorn smiled. Those Loyalists who survived but couldn't escape vanished into the wilderness. Sanguinius and the now depraved Blood Angels began to feast on the corpses of the dead. Sanguinius himself, giddy from the indulgence of devouring such sweet meat, smeared blood and gene fluid all over his skin like some vile lotion. Rogel Dorn then approached the kneeling form of Ferris Manus, who was cradling the headless form of Fulgrim. Dorn congratulated Ferris for being able to put aside the sentimentality, and that there would be time for all of them to weep in future, once they had reclaimed the Imperium from their father's tyranny. He then approached Vulcan and extended his hand. Vulcan took it and they shook wrist to wrist. Dorn praised his brother for seeing the light, and that their actions would be best for humanity. Vulcan couldn't look his brother in the eye, but he demanded to know where Gilliman was. The Lord of Ultramar tried to have him killed, and now he wished to enact justice. Dorn said that it sounded more like revenge, but Vulcan replied that right now, both meant the same thing. A pair of the Pyre Guard carried the limp form of Comrade Kurz. Vulcan informed Rogel Dorn that Kurz could be considered a present, a demonstration of his loyalty to the cause of a better Imperium for the good of humanity. The surviving members of the Thousand Suns recovered the STC that contained the data for constructing the Men of Iron. Azek Araman and Reviel Arvida, along with the few tech marines they had, examined the artifact. There was more than enough raw material
on the nearby moons to construct these mechanical abominations, but the moral dilemma was still there. These constructs had long ago turned on their human creators, and tried the best they could to make the human species extinct, before finally being put down by the Emperor himself. Ahriman considered building a small force of the constructs to supplement the Legion after their devastating losses at the hands of the Space Wolves. Reviel Arvidar was hesitant. He warned Ahriman that these things were destroyed for a reason by decree of the Emperor. Ahriman sadly responded that because of the Emperor's decree, their father was forbidden to read the signs that led to the revelation of Rogaldorn's rebellion. In this war, they may simply not have a choice. Ahriman decided to put the matter to a vote amongst their men. He may have been the leader of the Legion now, but such a huge decision shouldn't be undertaken lightly, especially one that could potentially condemn them all. A warning alarm began to blare throughout the vessel. The single ship was fast approaching. Its profile was that of the Runefire, a ship belonging to the Space Wolves Legion. The Thousand Suns vessels powered up their weapon systems and changed their course headings to intercept the Runefire head-on. The Runefire slowed its approach, and bizarrely, its weapon systems were offline, but the ship itself had no damage. The Runefire sent a transmission to the makeshift flagship of the Thousand Suns, the Scion of Prospero. The ship's captain contacted Ahriman over the intercom. He needed to come to the bridge. As Ahriman and Reviel Arvidar made their way to the bridge of the ship, their gaze was drawn to the image on the main screen. It was of a Space Wolf Legionnaire, unhelmed with a shaggy, rust-red beard and long, wild, unkempt hair. His pack marking on his pauldron marked him out as being part of the Tra, the Space Wolf's third company. The wolf began to speak. He stated that he and the men under his command had commandeered the Runefire and fled the Prospero system during the battle. They had witnessed their Primarch's transformation into nothing more than a monstrous beast. But while their brothers embraced the change as a blessing, this ragtag group of rogue wolves despised the direction their legion was heading in. It wasn't a blessing, it was a curse. Corruption, mutation, degradation into nothing more than mindless animals hungry for blood. These rogue wolves knew that they could never be forgiven for their legion's actions, and gave the Thousand Suns a choice. Either kill them as a small measure of revenge for their Primarch and homeworld, or accept them and allow the wolves to redeem themselves for their legion's actions as a whole, by fighting for the Emperor against their traitorous kin. Reviel Arvidar asked Ahriman if this could be some elaborate trick. Ahriman didn't think it was. The wolves were never known to use deception, even if they had turned from the light. Ahriman agreed to let the rogue wolves fight by their side, and as he invited them to board the Scion of Prospero, he asked for the name of the one he was speaking to. The wolf gave a single nod as he replied. His name was Bjorn. Within the Istvan system, the traitor legion sent patrols out on a daily basis as they awaited the return of the Space Wolves to attack Terra en masse. There were still pockets of resistance on the world, fighting a guerrilla war in the Emperor's name. Many of these patrols would return vastly under strength, as the loyalists would take their bloody toll on them. Those loyalists who were captured were given a choice: join or die. Most of them chose the latter. Gilliman received word from the stewards of Ultramar. His empire was being assaulted by the forces of the Word Bearers and World Eaters. Gilliman requested that Rogaldorn allow him to return to Ultramar with his legion and wipe out the loyalists. Rogue Dawn refused. The War Master stated that taking Terra was more important right now, and to double back towards the Eastern Fringes would only allow the Loyalists more time to prepare for the final conflict. Dawn received a transmission from the Phalanx. The White Scar's fleet was fast approaching. Rogue Dawn was surprised and ordered the fleet to prepare for battle. The White Scar's fleet was battered and scarred from their escape of their homeworld, and Jagatai Khan opened a transmission to the Phalanx. When he spoke, he sounded like a broken man, his heart heavy and full of woe and regret. The Emperor, their father, had betrayed him and cast him aside like some broken and useless object. He humbly requested for the White Scars to join with Rogue Dawn's forces. Upon the flame rot, Conrad Kurz slowly awoke to find himself naked and in chains, strapped to an anvil embossed with a dragon, the sigil of the Salamander's Legion. Vulcan stood over his pallid brother and looked at him sadly. Conrad demanded to be let go, or if he was going to be killed, to just get it over with. Vulcan shook his head. He had been given orders by the War Master. Interrogate and convert the Night Haunter to their cause, by any means necessary, much to Vulcan's sorrow. Vulcan picked up a white-hot branding iron and brought it to Kurz's chest. The Lord of Night could feel the intense heat emanating from the metal, and began to thrash around, not out of fear, but out of anger. Vulcan kindly asked his brother not to make him go through with such a cruel act. He had no desire to do such things, especially not to a brother, but the War Master had ordered him to do so. Kurz spat into Vulcan's face and snarled, and Vulcan sighed with sorrow and disappointment, and pressed the searing metal into his brother's pale flesh, causing him to howl in pain as his skin bubbled and blistered, the room being filled with a stench of burning meat. "Please," Vulcan begged Kurz, "join the War Master's side and end this unnecessary suffering." After several long, excruciating hours, Kurz went limp and panted heavily from exertion. He asked Vulcan to look into his heart and just kill him, put him out of his misery, and end his suffering. Vulcan pondered for a moment before agreeing. He asked his brother if he had any last requests, and Comrade Kurz asked to be unbound and killed with a swift blow to the head. Let him die as a warrior on his feet. Either through naivete or compassion, Vulcan agreed and unfastened the heavy chains that bound the Lord of Night. As soon as they were removed, Kurz lashed out with an intense psychic blast, hurling his giant of a brother back several feet into a weapons rack and shattering all glass and light within several meters from the epicenter of the blast. Kurz disappeared into the shadows and escaped into the bowels of the ship, laughing like a maniac all the while. Over the course of the next few days, as the Salamanders desperately tried to hunt down Comrade Kurz, they would discover the butchered and mutilated corpses of their kinsmen throughout the ship. Vulcan felt regret for his folly, but at the same time, part of his soul felt relieved, as if feeling he deserved punishment for his actions and his betrayal. When Vulcan finally retired to his chambers, he found the walls smeared in blood, with the words Ave Dominus Nox painted above the bed. The shattered legions who escaped the massacre of Istvan V raced towards Terra as fast as they could. Not only had the forces of the arch-traitor, Rogal Dorn, pushed back the Loyalist forces, but he had managed to sway the Dark Angels, the Raven Guard, and the Salamanders to his own cause. Even worse, the Primarch Fulgrim had given his life in the battle against his treacherous kin, and the Primarch Conrad Kurz had been reported missing. The Loyalists needed to regroup on Terra itself, the most heavily fortified world within the galaxy, now even more so thanks to the efforts of the Iron Warriors Legion. Upon Terra's holy soil, under the orders of Malkador the Sigilite, Perturabo, the Primarch of the Iron Warriors Legion, sent out a rallying call to the remaining Loyalist legions. Return to Terra, reinforce the defences, serve the Emperor, destroy the traitors. During their holy crusade of cleansing the tainted worlds of the Ultramar Empire, the Word Bearers and World Eaters received word of this message. Angron revelled in the chance for more fighting, clashing his immense chain axes together in a show of celebration at the fort on the bridge of his ship, the Conqueror. Lorgar, from his ship, the Divinitas Lex, bade for his brother to take his men and make for Terra as fast as possible. The Word Bearers would soon follow, after cleansing the last of these tainted worlds within the current system. Angron sheathed his blades, and for the first time, gave his smaller brother a salute of respect. He told Lorgar to hurry up, so he wouldn't miss the battle entirely. The World Eater's fleet then made the warp jump and headed for Terra. Upon the Iron Hand's flagship, the Fist of Iron, Ferris Manus was distraught. The trauma of murdering his most beloved friend and brother had hit him hard after the battle, and the Primarch had locked himself deep within his chambers. He stood over the decontamination basin and spent hours upon hours scrubbing his arms with stiff bristled brushes and wire wool, desperate to wash the blood of his brother off of him. His absence from the rest of his legion was a cause of concern for First Captain Gabriel Santar. Santar knocked on the chamber door, requesting if he could enter. All he could hear was the sound of scalding hot water gushing from the faucets, and the rough, frenzied scrubbing and screeching of metal scratching against metal, along with the Primarch's own distressed mumbling. Santar activated the override on the door's control panel and quickly entered, concerned for his Primarch. He gazed upon the naked form of Ferris Manus, whose body had been subjected to frenzied scrubbing and cleansing, leaving his flesh with several cuts and lacerations, particularly around his elbow, where the metal of his forearms met the flesh. The cuts and abrasions were in a pitiful state, and most of them looked, judging by the discoloration and stench, as if they were becoming infected.
The astropaths of the Lunar Wolves Legion received word of the order to return to Terra, and of the full extent of Rogal Dorn's betrayal. Horus Lupercal sank to his knees upon learning such news. His brother, Jagatai Khan, whom he had cast aside as a traitor, was right all along. The Primarch vowed that he would atone for this failure, and vowed to never again fail in his duties. The first captain of the Lunar Wolves, Ezekiel Abaddon, inquired if they should set course for Terra, as requested by Perturabo, or if they were to finish tracking down the remnants of the White Scar's fleet. Horus gave the order to return to the throne world of the Imperium.
They could never atone for what they did to Jagoras, but they could redeem themselves by serving the Emperor and defending the Imperial Palace. Horus ordered them to make way for Holy Terror. On Mars, the seat of power for the Mechanicum, Fabricator General Kelbor Hal received word from several of his forge worlds. The Legio Astartes and the Imperium at large were in the midst of a civil war. Traitors and loyalists alike were battling within Mechanicum territory, and both sides requested for the servants of the Machine God to resupply and repair their ships exclusively, a task that the Mechanicum were reluctant to do. The leader of the rebellion, Rogal Dorn, had made Mechanicum an offer. In exchange for providing them a staging ground within the Sol system for when Dorn's forces made their final push towards Terra, Rogal Dorn would allow the Mechanicum to retain their sovereignty as a sister empire in the new order to come. Kelbor Hal was admittedly tempted, but in the end declined this offer. This was a war concerning the Imperium and the Golden Throne of Terra. Kelbor Hal made a decree that all of the Forge Worlds of the Mechanicum Empire would follow under penalty of servitude in perpetuus. The Mechanicum would remain neutral in this war, unless the very Machine God itself declared otherwise. The news angered Rogal Dorn, for they were left no choice but to attack Terra itself as soon as possible. Without the Mechanicum and the resources its forge worlds provided, they would run low on fuel, ships, and ammunition. Time was beginning to run out, becoming a luxury they could not afford. While they had the support of a large portion of the Imperial Army and Imperial Navy to support them for the upcoming battle, the Loyalists still had a sizable amount of troops at their disposal. As soon as the Space Wolves fleet returned to the Istvan system, they would march towards Terra, and Rogal Dorn would take his father's throne. Vulcan and the Pyre Guard continued in their efforts to hunt down Conrad Kurz. The ship's crew had managed to isolate the Night Lord's Primarch in the main hangar bay, sealing the area shut with the emergency bulkheads. The problem was, the hangar airlocks to the bare void were locked tight and could not be opened. Something, or someone, had damaged the mechanism. Vulcan was left no choice. Gathering his bodyguards, they would enter the hangar bay and gun the Night Haunter down. Despite his brutal wave of killings upon the ship, Kurz was without his armor and without his weapons. As far as Primarchs go, it should be a relatively easy kill for veteran Astartes clad in tactical Terminator armor. As the bulkhead slowly raised, the salamanders entered the hangar. It was vast, filled with dozens of thunderhawks and stormbirds. The lights were bright, casting vast shadows throughout the room as the light shined over the multitude of dropships. Plenty of places to hide. Vulcan walked ahead first, brandishing his hammer, Dawnbringer. The hammer's energy field was already active, giving the head of the massive weapon an eerie blue glow. The Pyre Guard behind him held their weapons ready, aiming at the vast shadows, expecting the psychotic Night Haunter to spring up at any moment. Vulcan spoke, his deep, booming voice echoing throughout the hangar. He informed Kurz that he was trapped here, and once the airlock systems were repaired, he would be ejected into the icy void to die without dignity. But he could surrender himself, join their cause, and have all of his past crimes and atrocities forgiven. Vulcan demanded a response from his brother and waited. The lights suddenly cut out with a loud bang from overloading, glass raining from the ceiling like snow. The room became enshrouded in darkness, and screams and the sound of flesh being torn apart could be heard. When the emergency lighting kicked in, Vulcan turned around to see that all of his men had been butchered. He raised his hammer and took up a combat stance. His blood began to boil with anger and demanded that if Kurz wished to kill him, then do it as a warrior, face to face, mano a mano, with honor like a real warrior should. Vulcan heard the sound of footsteps on metal and quickly spun around, ready to bring his massive warhammer to bear. Instead, he felt the intense burning pain of lightning claws piercing through his armor, into his hearts and lungs, the crackling energy surging through Vulcan's massive frame. His glowing red eyes gazed upon the sight of his brother. Conrad Kurz was wearing a patchwork of crudely beaten armor, made from the armor of the salamanders he had slaughtered. Vulcan let his hammer fall from his grip, impacting the deck with a loud clang of metal. Conrad Kurz smiled with his sick vampiric grin and leaned in closer to his brother, whispering, "Father sends his regards." He pushed the lightning claws deeper into Vulcan's flesh, causing the primate to vomit up thick blood. Kurz then clenched his fist and ripped back, leaving a gaping hole in Vulcan's torso. He then eyed up one of the Thunderhawk gunships and softly laughed to himself. He unleashed a psychic blast at the airlock before boarding the Thunderhawk and opening fire with its weapon systems to force an opening for him to escape through. Vulcan's perpetual body began to slowly knit his wounds back together, but the last thing he would ever experience was a sudden rush of cold and the sensation of his body, along with every item not bolted down in the hangar, to be sucked out into the darkness of the void. Deep within the Imperial Palace upon Holy Terra, Malkador the Sigilite and Regent of Terra received word from the Shattered Legions. Malkador sighed and shook his head in sorrow. How could such a thing happen? He asked himself. He was disturbed by Perturabo and Mortarion. The massive Primarch of the Iron Warriors informed Malkador that Mechanicum had refused to give aid to either side in the upcoming conflict, declaring themselves neutral. Malkador nodded solemnly. He began to wonder how much worse could things get at this point. But at least this would also mean that the Separatists would also be running low on supplies. Mortarion the Death Lord, Primarch of the Death Guard, then posed a question. He asked that if the traitor supplies were low enough, would they launch an assault on Mars first, to try and capture a staging ground from which they could assault Holy Terra? If Rogue Dawn's forces were desperate enough, they might just very well do that. Malkador then decided to enact an extremely dangerous plan. He ordered that the Death Guard fleet take up orbit around Mars. While they would not request aid from the Mechanicum, they also needed to deny such a huge center of resources from falling into the hands of the enemy. Mortarion asked if such an action could trigger an armed response from Mars, but Malkador quelled his fears, stating that as long as they did not fire upon nor set foot upon the Red World, the Mechanicum would be content in being left alone. But this raised another issue. By defending Mars in such a way, it would starve Terra of warriors to protect it. Malkador agreed, but stated that they had little to no choice in this matter. One of the main problems with warp travel that both sides encountered in this conflict is that it was unpredictable. But this unpredictability proved beneficial for the Loyalist forces, as two fleets entered the Sol system. The Lunar Wolves, led by Horus Lupercal, and the World Eaters, led by Angron. Seemingly through sheer blind luck, they had arrived ahead of Rogel Dorn's forces. For that, Malkador gave a sigh of relief. Finally, some good news. As the word bearers finished purifying the system from the taint of corruption, they began to make their way to Terra. Before they made the warp jump, the flagship of the Legion, the Divinitas Lex, received a transmission from the Scion of Prospero. Lorgar was surprised to see Thousand Suns so far out into the eastern fringes. He was even more surprised to see that the trio of Thousand Suns vessels was accompanied by a Space Wolf ship. Azek Araman and Bjorn explained their unusual partnership to Lorgar and requested to join with the Wordbearer's fleet for strength in numbers. Lorgar smiled and agreed. Lorgar then gave a great inspirational speech to the ragtag fleet, bordering upon turning into a religious sermon, such was his passion and vigor. The traitors will be purged. Those loyal to the Emperor and the Imperium will find glory. And those who have turned from his light shall be wiped from existence and memory. With rapturous applause, even from the stoic warriors of the Thousand Suns, the fleet marched to reinforce Terra. Rogel Dorn's great host floated in the void, awaiting his orders. The fabric of reality tore open with a kaleidoscope of colours, as the forces of the demon Primarch Leman Russ finally rejoined the host. The currents of the warp had been unstable, and what should have been a journey for a few days had taken weeks. The Primarchs all sent a transmission to Rogel Dorn. Leman Russ was the first to speak, demanding to know when he and his wolves will be unleashed upon Terra. Rogel Dorn let out a sly grin and promised the bestial creature that was once his brother that the time for action was nigh. There will be plenty of blood to quench his thirst many times over. Sanguinius sat impatiently on his throne, using the skull of a loyalist as a palate, and using the dried blood and viscera to use as a form of primitive makeup to accentuate his beauty, his purple eyes almost glowing. Throughout the Blood Angels' fleet, captured loyalists were tortured, their screams turned into fine musical notes by grossly oversized Fox speakers that the Blood Angels' tech marines and apothecaries had surgically implanted into the loyalists' faces. Rebute Gilliman led his men in prayer to the gods of the warp, begging them to bestow his men with their blessings. Corvus Corax, Lionel Johnson, and Jagatai Khan reported into Rogel Dorn. Unlike their brothers, they seemed to remain true to their own natures, and had not yet been perverted, or blessed, as Gilliman would describe it. Ferris Manus, however, was nowhere to be seen. Instead, his first captain, Gabriel Centaur, had sent his transmission, informing Rogel Dorn that the Iron Hands were ready. Warmaster Rogel Dorn sent out a transmission to every vessel in the fleet and began a grand speech. He told his men that they had come far in this great conflict, and that they were the ones who were on the right side of history. He told his men that by taking the throne world of the Imperium, the tyranny of their father, the Emperor of Mankind, would be wiped away forever, leaving the citizens of the Imperium free to indulge in whatever acts they wished, be it of religious worship or scientific advancement. They would fulfill their every heart's desire without the iron fist of the Emperor beating them down. They will march upon Terra and install a great republic, removing the dictatorship and monarchy and casting it aside to the darkness of humanity's own senseless past. To war, to victory, to liberation, for the greater good of humanity. The great fleet then dived into the warp, setting course for the Sol system. as the traitor armada raced through warp space. The Iron Hand's flagship, the Fist of Iron, hit extreme turbulence and became separated from the rest of the armada. Ferris Manus demanded that his tech marines and librarians find a way to rejoin the War Master's forces. The tides of the warp grew ever more unstable from the sheer volume of ships all entering at once, leaving the Fist of Iron floating like a raft in a great ocean, while other vessels abandoned them. The tech marines on board began to report a greater and more important issue than just being marooned within the warp. The ship's Geller field was starting to fail. As the Geller field slowly flickered and died upon the Fist of Iron, the ship was left at the mercy of the Neverborn that caressed the iron flesh of the ship with their claws. A strange contagion began to infect the ship. First, only the ship's crew and Legion serfs seemed to be susceptible to the disease, their flesh slowly bloating and distending, creating a foul stench as pus and other bodily fluids began to ooze from their ears, eyes, nose, and mouths. The Legion itself was unconcerned, for they were Astartes, and as the Emperor himself decreed, no sickness would blight them. However, they were terribly wrong. Soon the contagion began to affect members of the Legion, but unlike those mortal humans who were infected, it seemed that the disease was even more agonizing for the Astartes to suffer through, feeling their bodies buckle and rot from the inside out. Worst yet, the disease began to affect the Primarch, Ferris Manus. The liquid metal of his arms began to oxidize and corrode, turning from gleaming silver to dull red rust. The infection began to travel up his arms, the flesh beginning to peel from his bones as his skin bubbled and blistered, pus-filled cysts growing and bursting with the stench of rot and decay. Around him, Ferris Manus began to watch his Legion succumb to this otherworldly sickness, seeing his sons vomit up their own internal organs and collapse before their bodies began to slowly liquefy into a putrid sludge. In his desperation, he begged for aid, for someone, anyone, to spare him and his Legion. He would give his very soul to save his Legion. And with that offer came salvation from the oldest power within the warp. The dead began to rise, and those still living began to no longer feel pain and discomfort from the sickness. The Iron Hands were forever changed, their armor encrusted with slime and vile filth. Those with bionics found their prosthetics corroded and caked with rust. Ferris Manus himself found that his armor bore a new sigil. Instead of the shining hand of iron, it was now skeletal, engraved with a trio of orb-like skulls. Gone now were the iron hands, and in their place were born the hands of decay, foul plague-ridden parodies of the once proud and noble Astartes they once were. Nurgle's new champion, Ferris Manus, ordered, with a voice now sickly wet and raspy, for his Legion to rejoin the War Master, so that they may bring Nurgle's gifts to his brothers. The traitorous host began to emerge from the warp in the outskirts of the Sol system. The Phalanx was the first ship to arrive, followed by the rest of the Imperial Fist's fleet. The newly christened Flesh Wolves would arrive soon after, as did the Blood Angels, Raven Guard, Dark Angels, White Scars, and Ultramarines. The Iron Hands were the last to arrive, and now, even their ships had changed. Once proud gleaming obelisks of silver and black were bare rusted metal. Even in the sterile environment of the void, the Iron Hands emitted an aura
of corruption and decay. As the traitor armada prepared to attack, Rogal Dorn ordered for Rabute Gilliman's fleet to form a blockade around Terra. As the largest legion, the Ultramarines would be the perfect rearguard to prevent any returning loyalists from reinforcing Terra. Korax was ordered to establish a zone within the orbit of Mars to attempt and acquire resources of ships and ammunition from the Forge World. Upon the new flagship of the Raven Guard, the Avenger, Korax nodded and ordered his forces to set course for Mars, while the rest of the armada continued towards Terra. The Raven Guard disgorged drop pods and Thunderhawk gunships from their barges, which descended towards Mars to convince the Mechanicum to reconsider their neutrality in this war. On the view screen, he could see numerous explosions light up the outer atmosphere of Mars. The bridge crew reported that the dropships were being shot down. Corvus Korax simply assumed it was the planetary defense batteries of Mars itself, but the incoming frantic reports from the bridge crew debunked that assumption. On a direct intercept course for the Raven Guard was the full might of the Death Guard fleet. Mortarion, standing upon the command lectern of his flagship, the Endurance, raised his massive Man Reaper, Silence, at the screen and ordered his fleet to open fire. A great void battle erupted within the orbit of Mars. Streaks of lance and torpedo fire lit up the void, along with the kaleidoscopic flashes of void shield impacts as intercept craft flew between the great ships, engaging in dogfights with one another. Mortarion ordered the Death Shroud to make ready the boarding torpedoes. Mortarion wished to cut down his traitorous brother, personally. Rogal Dorn received word that the Raven Guard fleet was under attack, but he dismissed their concerns. They simply needed to keep the Death Guard at bay while the rest of the army took the palace as soon as possible. He gave the order, and like rain, millions of drop pods and gunships descended onto Terra, lighting up the atmosphere, turning the once pale blue sky to a fiery red, while the ships in orbit would bombard the orbital defense platforms and weapons batteries upon the surface. Perturabo ordered the defense systems to open fire, and with thunderous booms, massive weapons batteries the size of small mountains began to discharge their shots into the sky. Streaks of blinding laser fire and flak impacting thousands upon thousands of traitor ships and drop pods, causing them to explode like some vile fireworks display. Upon the Invincible Reason, Lionel Johnson prepared to board his personal Stormbird dropship alongside the veteran warriors of the Deathwing. As the ship descended to the planet's surface, leaving a burning trail within the atmosphere, a single Astartes, clad in Corvus pattern power armor, said that he had an important message for the Primarch. As Lionel Johnson inquired about this message, the Astartes' response was simple. "I am Alpharius." The spy from Istvan had revealed himself at last and detonated a concealed melter charge hidden upon his person, causing a massive explosion within the Stormbird's hull, causing many of the Dark Angels on board to be sucked out of the now gaping hole in the dropship, including Lionel Johnson himself, who fell hundreds of feet and impacted into the ground with a sickening crunch. The lion slowly opened his eyes and sat up in agony. He looked at the sight above him, watching his personal dropship impact into the planet's surface, and with a deafening eruption of smoke and fire, growled to himself in frustration and rage. The traitor forces stormed towards the Imperial Palace, shouting their war cries and their devotion to the War Master. They were met with miles upon miles of vast trench networks filled with the warriors of the Iron Warriors Legion and heavy weaponry emplacements. The loyalists opened fire with the heavy clatter of bolter fire, searing hiss of Lascarnum fire, and a deafening boom of missile launchers. So vast was the network of trenches that the warriors of the White Scars were forced to abandon the use of their bikes, leaving them in the wayside as they marched alongside their allies. Slowly, though, the traitors began to gain ground, forcing the Iron Warriors back inch by inch, paying in blood for every meter of ground they covered. Leman Russ and his demonically blessed sons were the spear tip of this traitorous assault, carving their way through the defences with tooth, claw, and warp-tainted blade. Russ roared like the beast he had now become, carving through the Loyalists with ease. After many hours, the Iron Warriors were forced back to the gates of the Imperial Palace itself. They were granted a reprieve. Along the battlements of the fortress-like walls of the palace, the Lunar Wolves opened fire, providing valuable cover fire for the Iron Warriors to fall back and regroup. As the gates were opened to let them through, a horde of screaming berserkers, clad in white and blue, stormed out, their chain blades buzzing and whirring like a frenzied swarm of insects. At their head was the Gladiator King himself, Angron, Primarch of the World Eaters. He carved through the traitors that dared come close. Though numerous and desperate, they were nowhere near the skill level that Angron had desired. He was hoping for a challenge. Through the swirling melee of the combat, Angron and the demon Primarch, Leman Russ, locked eyes. Angron lowered his massive chain axe, Gorefather, at the demon, and bellowed a challenge at him. Finally, something worth testing his skill against. Leman Russ roared, and with a thunderous flap of his leathery wings, launched himself towards his berserker of a brother. Sparks flew off both Primarch's blades as they hacked and parried at one another. Their blades locked, and Leman Russ growled a bestial laugh. He mocked Angron, saying that he had already killed Magnus the Red, and that Angron would soon join him in death. Angron gritted his teeth and spat back at him. Russ had forgotten that Angron had beaten him in a duel before, and he will again. Leman Russ lunged forward and bit down upon Angron's shoulder, tearing apart the ceramite of his armor and leaving a deep, bloody wound, causing Angron to snarl in pain. Angron used all of his might to push Russ back, before swinging his second chain axe, Gorechild, directly between Leman Russ's legs, the whirling teeth of the axe biting deep into the demon's groin, causing him to howl like a castrated mutt. Russ bellowed in fury and lashed out with the butt of his weapon, knocking the Gladiator King to the dirt. As he raised his sword to finish him off, he felt an intense pain in his forearm, as the World Eater's captain, Khan the Bloody, hacked his own axe into the demon Primarch's flesh. Russ lashed out with a clenched fist, striking Khan with such force that he went flying directly into the gates of the palace with a heavy clang. Khan groaned, disoriented, before blacking out. Leman Russ roared in triumph. Their victory was assured. Rabute Gilliman smiled, sat upon his throne on his flagship. His fleet, along with the Imperial Fists, had formed a blockade around Terra. No one would escape from the throne world this day. A proximity alarm began to sound throughout the ship. Another fleet had just arrived within the Sol system. Rogal Dawn ordered Gilliman to hold them back. The forces on Terra needed just a few more hours to claim their victory. The forces of the Word Bearers, Thousand Suns, and the Loyalist Space Wolves had entered the system, travelling towards Terra as fast as they could go. The Ultramarines Legion moved to intercept. The void ignited as lance fire was exchanged between the great fleets, impacting into void shields, igniting with a kaleidoscope of colour. The Ultramarines' fleet was much larger than the combined armada of the Loyalists, a fact that had not gone unnoticed
by the commander of the Thousand Suns, Azek Ahriman. Ahriman ordered for the boarding torpedoes to be readied. Revel Arvidar was stunned. A boarding action? With so few soldiers? Was Ahriman out of his mind? Ahriman smiled, stating that he had a plan. Boarding torpedoes launched from the sign of Prospero and burned through the shipfire, striking the Ultramarine's vessel, the Gauntlets of Power. Gilliman was surprised to see the Thousand Suns attempt such brutal tactics. In his arrogance, he dismissed the boarding action as a bluff. There was no way the Thousand Suns would attempt such a tactic, especially when their numbers were so few. As the ship's crew and tech adepts attempted to seal the hull breaches on the Gauntlet of Power, the boarding torpedoes clicked and whirled open, the head of the torpedoes opening up with a hydraulic whine and hiss of escaping gas. Within the shadows of the boarding torpedo, various eyes lit up, glowing a luminescent green. The ship's crew recoiled in horror at what emerged from within. Mechanical monstrosities, shaped like a man, their heads gleaming silver skulls, marching forward and beginning to butcher with their iron claws all who stood in their way. The men of iron chanted their orders over and over again in a heavily distorted robotic monotone. Death to the traitors. Death to the traitors. Gilliman continued to observe the battle, directing its course and broadcasting orders to the various ships under his command. An alarm klaxon began to blare throughout the bridge. They had been boarded. Impossible, Gilliman thought. The ship had not been struck by any torpedoes. There soon came reports of heavy fighting on the engineering deck, panicked requests for reinforcements and aid before the transmissions fell silent. Gilliman slammed his fist down on the arm of his throne. Did he have to do everything himself? Gilliman and the Terminator-clad Astartes of the First Company marched to the engine room, seeing the corpses of his men fill the corridors. No other bodies were found. Whoever had boarded them must have been a highly skilled unit. As Gilliman entered the engine room, he was met with a familiar sight. "Hello, brother." Gilliman was horrified. It was impossible. For standing before him was none other than Conrad Kurz, the Night Haunter, had come for him.
The traitor legions were closing in on the palace gates. Angron, well wounded, was not going to give up without a fight. As Leman Russ roared, preemptive of his triumph, Angron leapt up high and brought both of his chain axes down onto the Demon Primarch's face, spraying demonic ichor all over his body as the whirling teeth of the weapons drank deep. The Demon Primarch's body began to become unstable, as if his grip on the material realm was weakening. Despite the valiant efforts of the World Eaters, they were soon ordered to fall back into the palace itself. Angron cursed, saying that he would not flee, but a voice soon entered his mind. "Fall back into the palace," it commanded him. A voice of sheer authority echoed throughout his mind, drowning out the butcher's nails themselves. "Fall back. Your skills will be needed here," his father, the Emperor of Mankind, ordered him. Reluctantly, Angron called for a retreat. As the palace gates opened, huge lumbering machines emerged from it, clad in the colours and livery of the Loyalist legions. 50 dreadnoughts thundered forward. They would hold the gate as long as possible. The towering machines readied their weapons and opened fire with a storm of missile, bolt, las, and melter fire. The dreadnought leading them, the Emperor's children, ancient Rylanor, made a declaration, his voice booming like metallic thunder. "You shall not pass."
The dreadnoughts knew that none of them would survive this day, but they would give their very lives to protect humanity and their emperor. Lehman Russ fell under the storm of heavy weapons fire and roared in defiance. He attempted to push forward, but his form was becoming less and less stable. With a deafening bang and flash of blinding light, Lehman Russ howled and whimpered as his form was banished back to the warp, where he would be unable to return for over 1,000 years. Despite the loss of the demon Primarch, the traitors pushed on, now more desperate than ever. Far from the Imperial Palace, near the population centers of the civilians and members of the Administratum, the Blood Angels, led by their Primarch Sanguinius, descended, intent on capturing slaves and raw materials to concoct more of their own special narcotics. The Angel himself strode amongst his men as they maimed and captured those who could not or would not fight. To hell with Rogel Dorn's plans. Right now, the Blood Angels needed more stimulation on their endless quest for pleasure. As Sanguinius watched his men corral their prizes, he was surprised to see a company of ultramarines approach them. Sanguinius smiled, brushing the long flowing hair away from his face. He asked if Rebute Gilliman had sent them to escort him back to the siege of the Imperial Palace. The ultramarine's captain removed his helmet and maglocked it to his hip, and drew his power sword, thumbing the activation rune, causing the weapon to light up a pale blue as lightning arced across its length. Aeonid Theol lowered his weapon at Sanguinius and stated, "No, they had come to stop them." Upon the gauntlet of power, the ultramarines on board were all slaughtered, leaving the ship's corridors slicked with blood and viscera of human and post-human remains. The men of iron began to interface with the systems of the vast ship, continuing to chant their robotic mantra, proclaiming death to the traitors. As the cybernetic constructs began to merge with the ship itself, they assumed direct control of the vast craft, turning it against the rest of the Ultramarine's fleet, opening fire with its vast lance and torpedo batteries. Rogel Dorn, watching from the phalanx, was stunned. What was Gilliman's Legion doing? He ordered the fleet to destroy the rogue craft, and as the vessels nearby opened fire upon the gauntlets of power, the ship itself began to split and buckle as its structural integrity began to fail. The ship fired its sublight's engines at full speed into the heart of the Ultramarine's fleet, and then an uncontrolled warp jump was activated, causing a yawning warp rift that devoured dozens and dozens of ships with a flash of crackling energy before closing. Rogel Dorn was dumbfounded. Who in their right mind would attempt such a suicidal move? But the Warmaster began to receive even worse news. The Raven Guard fleet was forced to flee, and the Death Guard was fast approaching to reinforce the Loyalists. Rogel Dorn raged, ripping monitors off the walls around him and hurling them with all of his might, causing them to shatter in an explosion of metal and glass. The tide was fast turning against him. It was time to make a dangerous gambit. The Emperor sat upon the Golden Throne, using his immense power to keep the warp tear caused by Jagatai Khan in check. Malkador approached him to report the progress of the battle. The traitors would soon breach the palace gates. The Legio Custodi stood ready, clad in power armor, tactical dreadnought armor, and including mighty dreadnoughts. The doors to the throne room opened, and the Primarchs Horus, Perturabo, and the wounded Angron entered, along with several marines from the Lunar Wolves, World Eaters, and Iron Warriors. Time was running out, and it looked as if this would be the last stand. The Emperor then received a psychic vision. Rogel Dorn had challenged the Emperor to a final showdown on board the phalanx. The Emperor needed to act fast. This could be the final decisive blow needed to end the rebellion once and for all. The Emperor instructed Malkador to take his place upon the Golden Throne, to keep the spilling energies of the warp in check, while the Emperor would deal with his wayward son himself. Horus, Perturabo, and Angron all demanded they fight alongside their father, but the Emperor decreed that the defences still needed to have a commander. Perturabo was chosen to remain in command of the defence of the palace, much to his dismay, but he agreed nonetheless. Horus Lupercal stated to his most trusted warriors, Garviel Loken, Ezekiel Abaddon, Tarek Torgadon, and Malagurs the Twisted, known collectively as the Mournivore, to aid Perturabo and act as his ears and eyes, relaying his orders to the Astartes. The Emperor then turned to Ezekiel Abaddon, captain of the Lunar Wolves' first company. The Emperor gave a special order to him, to hunt down and kill any and all enemy commanders, to weaken their resolve. Abaddon would become the Emperor's champion. The Emperor activated a great teleportation device within the throne room, and the loyalists soon found themselves upon the twisted vessel known as the Phalanx.
Within the engine room of the Ultramarines flagship, Rebute Gilliman and Conrad Kurz were locked in combat. Sparks flew as the Primarchs rained blow after blow onto one another with thunderous clangs, the hissing of their energy weapon fields, and a screeching of tearing metal. Gilliman roared in anger as he rained punch after punch onto the Night Lord's Primarch, screaming at him. "Why won't you just die?" he demanded. Conrad Kurz was laughing like a maniac as he slashed with his lightning claws. He had seen his death, and it does not come this day. Gilliman hurled Kurz into the reactor, causing him to bounce off the shielding, landing on the floor with a hard clang. Kurz picked himself up and lunged at Gilliman, slashing wildly, cutting deep into Gilliman's face, bisecting his left eye, causing Gilliman to howl in pain. The Ultramarines Astartes surrounding them raised their weapons at Kurz and began to open fire. Kurz darted out of the way with his unnatural speed before stampeding through the Astartes. Kurz turned back to his brother and smirked. "Another time, brother." He laughed and darted out of the room. Gilliman ordered Kurz to be killed by any means necessary. The man who brought him Kurz's head would be handsomely rewarded. The ship was rocked with the impact of boarding torpedoes carving their way through the hull. The torpedoes opened and the rogue wolves led by Bjorn emerged, taking advantage of the panicked Ultramarines on board. The tide was turning. The loyalists could actually win. With a crackle of jade energy and a flash of blinding light, the Emperor appeared on board of the War Master's flagship, the Phalanx. The Emperor was alone. The others must have been separated during the teleportation process. There was little time to ponder, however. Rogal Dor needed to be defeated. The Emperor looked in horror at what the ship was slowly becoming. Eyes blistered after the now fleshy walls, leering faces and screaming mouths mocked him as he walked through the slick, wet and sickly humid corridors. Traitor marines and demonic creatures tried to hold him around every corner, but the Emperor reduced them to smouldering remains as he effortlessly cleaved through them with his flaming blade and claw. He slowly and methodically made his way to the bridge of the ship. That's where Rogal Dorn would be. He was sure of it. Angron revved up his chain axes as he walked through the corridors of the ship, like a tiger pacing in a cage. He growled in frustration. He didn't expect to end up alone, but it mattered not. As he made his way through the passageways, he finally found himself on the bridge, and standing before him was his brother, Rogal Dorn. Dorn turned slowly to face Angron. The Gladiator King revved his axes and snarled.
he told the War Master that he could not wait to kill him. Rogel Dorn, however, bade Angron to stay his hand. He began to explain his reasoning and how Angron should join his cause. His legion would be the protectors of a new Imperium, a new empire, and become blessed by the epitome of war, the Blood God himself. Angron let out a loud belly laugh. He told Rogel Dorn that religious ideals were the pathetic beliefs and excuses held by the weak. And Angron wasn't weak. No, he was strong. Stronger than Rogel Dorn ever was. And Angron would present the traitor's skull to their father as tribute. He gunned his chain axes and roared as he charged towards his brother.
Horus Lupercal and the few Astartes and Custodes that accompanied him battled their way up through the decks of the phalanx. Brutal firefights erupted as the Fists of Dorn and the demonic creatures that accompanied them mounted a desperate counteroffensive against the Loyalists. The Custodes, resplendent in their golden armor, carved through the traitors with ease with their guardian spears, while the Legio Astartes laid down a suppressing fire. Horus Lupercal lashed out with his great mace, Worldbreaker, and opened fire with the combi bolter mounted upon his lightning claw, the Talon. Their only objective was to find the Emperor and protect him, no matter the cost. Angron and Rogel Dorn clashed. The great teeth of Angron's weapons, Gorefather and Gorechild, grinding and locking with the great double-handed blade of the War Master, Storm's teeth. Sparks flew from both great weapons as the two Primarchs, like ancient gods of war, dueled. Both men knew that only one of them would survive this day, intent on killing one another. The berserker rage of the Gladiator King against the technical precision of the War Master. Animalistic savagery versus iron discipline. Rogel Dorn parried and flipped Gorefather from Angron's grip, causing it to slide across the cold metal floor with a screech and splutter as the teeth slowly ceased their whirring and buzzing. Dorn followed up with a devastating blow to Angron's shoulder, the wound that Lehman Russ had inflicted upon him earlier. Angron screamed in pain, while Rogel Dorn gave a pitiless, emotionless stare. Storm's teeth carved deep into Angron's flesh, through his ribcage, spraying blood and shards of bone into the air. In desperation, Angron gripped Gorechild in both hands and struck hard against Rogel Dorn's torso, with a deafening clang, tearing open his armor with the scream of ripping ceramite. Rogel Dorn pulled his blade back and swung once more, severing Angron's head from his body. The corpse swaying before falling to its knees and falling forward onto the floor with a thud. Poor Angron, Rogel thought. If only he had joined the War Master's cause, he'd still be alive. As he reveled in his victory, a blinding light caught his attention. The Emperor had appeared. The Master of Mankind looked to the corpse of his son before focusing his gaze to Rogel Dorn. How could you? He thought. How dare you? The Emperor raised his flaming sword and told Rogel Dorn that this coup was over. He will stand down and face judgment. Rogel Dorn shook his head. He had taken things this far already, and he wasn't going to stop now. The Imperium was his, and all that was left was to dispose of his tyrannical father. The Emperor gave Rogel Dorn one last chance
for he would show no mercy to his traitorous son. Rogaldorn smiled as the shard of the oculus around his neck began to glow. Four towering figures materialized behind him, snarling and growling monstrosities of leathery red skin, putrid masses of green rot, iridescent blue feathers, and pale fleshy claws of chitin. Rogaldorn told the Emperor that he would not be showing mercy either. The four demonic creatures roared and screamed as they launched themselves at the Emperor. The Ultramarines' fleet was in disarray. The unexpected loss of over half of their fleet to the uncontrolled warp jump, thanks to the hijacking at the hands of the Men of Iron, with the combined arrival of the Death Guard fleet and assaults at the hands of the Rogue Wolves, resulted in many of the Ultramarine ships breaking rank, some even retreating away from the battle. Azek Araman saw this as the perfect opportunity. He ordered for the boarding torpedoes to be filled with 1,000 Suns assault troops and launched at the remaining Ultramarine ships. Araman and the remaining librarians of the Legion would use their powers to guide them directly into the very bridges of the ships to take them out in swift strikes. As the torpedoes launched, the Death Guard and Word Bearers joined in the counter-assault. Lorgar punched the air in preemptive triumph. The battle was turning in their favour. On Terra, the Loyalist Ultramarines battled to save the civilian population from the unnatural hungers of the Blood Angels. Aeonid Thiel swung his power sword against a master-crafted blade and carmine of Sanguinius. The perverse Primarch, effortlessly blocking and parrying the blows with one hand, smiling and laughing like a petulant child. He wasn't even trying to defend himself. He was finding himself quite entertained at the spectacle of a lesser being even thinking he could challenge a Primarch. Theor knew that if Sanguinius actually tried to do so, he could easily break him in half, but carried on regardless. Lionel Johnson watched from a distance. He turned his gaze back to the Imperial Palace and began to hear the chatter of the communications feed of panic from the forces in Orbis. He began to reconsider his choice in joining the War Master, thinking of who to side with and how he would cover up his treachery. Paterabo and the Mournival continued their command of the defense of the Imperial Palace. Paterabo watched as the traitors began to start breaking through the gates. Whatever the Emperor's plan was, he hoped it would work. Ezekiel Abaddon and the Lunar Wolves' First Company fought along the battlements as the traitors' assault troops began scaling the walls. Abaddon singled out the Imperial Fist's first captain, Sigismund, who led the assault. Abaddon gripped his power sword tight and bellowed a challenge to the so-called Black Knight. Sigismund lowered his blade to Abaddon, accepting the challenge, and in the swirling chaos of the melee, the two captains marched towards one another. Like knights of ancient legend, the two captains rained blow after blow after blow onto one another, as their great blades, each strike leading to a block, to a sweep, to a sidestep. Sigismund was good. He was very good. But Abaddon had the righteous blessing of the Emperor himself behind him. After several minutes of intense dueling, Abaddon impaled the Imperial Fist's captain before casting his body back over the walls with a sweep of his lightning claw. Abaddon looked around, searching for the next being to challenge the Emperor's champion. Upon the Ultramarines' flagship, Bjorn and the Rogue Wolves cut their way through the Ultramarines who stood in their path. Bjorn's target was Rebute Gilliman himself, the man who led his legion down the path of corruption. Bjorn reasoned that if they could kill Gilliman, then it would be a small redemption of the wolves in the eyes of the Emperor himself. They sprinted down the corridors until they encountered the ferocious Primarch. Bjorn smiled a predator's grin. Finally, his chance for redemption had come. Bjorn charged the Primarch, bringing his lightning claw to bear. But Gilliman grabbed the wolf by the wrist, and with a sudden motion, ripped Bjorn's arm from its socket, causing him to howl in agony, spraying blood all over the walls. The drops that touched the weapon's energy field fizzed and sizzled with the stench of frying meat. Gilliman grabbed another rogue wolf and slammed his head through the wall with a sickening crack of pulping bone. One by one, he cleaved his way through the wolves, leaving a pile of bodies in his wake. Bjorn fought to his feet, drawing a knife that was maglocked to his hip. He turned to Gilliman and growled, "I'm still alive, you motherless bastard!" Gilliman slowly turned to face the now one-armed Bjorn and smiled. "If this dog so desired to be put down, then so be it." With a deafening crash, Conrad Kerr slammed into Gilliman from behind, and the two brothers clashed once more. Bjorn received a transmission from Ahriman. The Wordbearer's fleet as a whole had a clear line of fire of the Ultramarine's flagship. Bjorn and his men needed to retreat. The wolf spat a mouthful of blood and nodded, before hobbling away reluctantly. The demonic creatures launched themselves at the Emperor. But the Emperor, despite his own objections, was a god incarnate. One by one, he banished the foul creatures back to the warp, cleaving the great unclean one in two with his flaming sword, tearing the head of the Lord of Change with his lightning claw, and vaporizing the Keeper of Secrets with sheer force of will before finally dispatching the Bloodthirster, who managed to wound the Emperor with a crack of his burning whip. The Emperor, then in a motion as swift as daylight itself, charged towards his son, and the two locked blades, the flaming sword of the Emperor beginning to melt its way through Storm's teeth. The two were surprisingly well matched, matching blow for blow, neither managing to land a strike on the other. The gods of the warp had chosen Rogal Dorn as their champion, and Rogal Dorn will bring a new glorious golden age to humanity. The Emperor told his son that he was deluded. The warp cannot be controlled, it cannot be bargained with. It was controlling him. The Emperor landed a mighty blow that knocked Rogal Dorn to the ground, and the Emperor raised his blade to finish him off. But for a split second, he hesitated. Yes, this man was a traitor. Yes, this man was responsible for the deaths of untold thousands. But this man was still his son. As the Emperor hesitated, Rogal Dorn let out a storm of warp lightning upon the Emperor, causing the Emperor to scream in pain. His divine features began to burn and wither. One of his eyes exploded within its socket, and the arm holding his flaming sword was severed at the elbow, causing the weapon to clatter to the ground and become extinguished. The Emperor fell down to one knee, struggling to stand, his features racked with pain. And Rogal Dorn stood above, looking down on him. Rogal Dorn's eyes widened, as if the true enormity of what he had done had just sunken in. The War Master fell to his knees and began to weep. He gazed into his father's eye and began to mutter that he was sorry. How he was so, so sorry. For a brief moment, the gods of the warp had their grip on the War Master weakened. And in desperation, the Emperor extended his sole remaining hand. Rogal Dorn nodded, knowing what was to come. Horus Lupercal appeared on the bridge at the exact moment the Emperor unleashed what little of his powers he had left, punching a hole through Rogal Dorn's body where Angron had struck him. the intensity of the psychic blast causing Rogaldorn's armor to be turned to dust, before his body exploded in a blinding flash of light. Not a trace of Rogaldorn remained. No bone, skin, not even his soul was spared from the blast. The Emperor fell back and laid still. Horus Lupercal rushed over to his father's side, his armor wheezing and clanking as he ran as fast as his cataphracty plate would allow him to. He cradled his dying father in his arms and wept. The Emperor raised his hand to his son's cheek and smiled softly. "The Golden Throne," he said. "Take me to the Golden Throne, and I may yet survive." Horus picked his father up in his arms and raised a communique to the Imperial Palace as the custodians and loyalist Astartes entered the bridge soon after, requesting for immediate teleportation back to the palace. With the psychic shockwave of Rogaldorn's death, the traitor forces began to flee. The War Master was dead. The war was over. The loyalist forces cheered as they mounted a final counterattack on the traitors besieging them, causing them to flee. Perturabo sighed in relief. They had won, and for the first time in years, began to smile and laugh. Sanguinius ordered for the Blood Angels to retreat, to take what goods they had and escape while they still could. Aeonid Theo delivered a mighty swing of his power sword that left a deep gash across the angel's face. Sanguinius hissed in fury. He didn't have time for this. The rebellion was over. All that mattered was to retreat while they still could. He unleashed a blast of kinetic force that knocked Theo to the ground and left. Lionel Johnson began to try and skulk away, but a familiar sight appeared before him. Before he had a chance to react, Alpharius impaled his brother with the weapon, the Pale Spear. Lionel Johnson felt his body weakening before falling to his knees. Alpharius smiled and walked away. A crackling green light filled the throne room of the Imperial Palace, and Horus Lupercal hurried to the Golden Throne, the frail body of the Emperor in his arms. The deceased body of Malkador the Sigillite was removed from the throne, his life been snuffed out by the stress of having to keep the turbulent energies of the warp in check for so long. The Regent of Terror, the Hero of Terror, would be given a funeral worthy of his accomplishments. The Lunar Wolves carried the body of the hero, Angron, whose sacrifice allowed the Emperor to defeat the traitor. His body would be returned to his legion out of respect. Meanwhile, on the Ultramarine's flagship, Rabute Gilliman and Comrade Kurz continued their duel. The very ship began to explode around them as the Wordbearer's fleet opened fire. Gilliman roared in frustration, and Kurz laughed like a maniac as Oblivion claimed both of them. As the Emperor was connected into the Golden Throne, with various pipes and tubes invading his body like some vast mechanical leeches, Perturabo entered the throne room, seeing the teary-eyed expression of sorrow spread across Horus Lupercal's face. He dropped his massive thunder hammer with a clang and hurried towards his father and knelt down before him. The Emperor slowly opened his eye and began to speak his final words before his sons. He told his sons that the traitors will be wiped from history. Their homeworlds were to be purged, and their coordinates wiped from the archives. It would be as if the traitor Primarchs never existed. The Emperor weakly lifted his hand to Horus, who took the frail skeletal limb in his massive gauntlets at hand and stroked it tenderly. The Emperor told his sons that he was sorry that everything had to come to this. But Horus and Perturabo were his sons, and their loyalty and heroic actions made him proud to be their father. His final decree was a great monument to the unsung heroes of the conflict. Malkador, the hero of terror, and Angron, the Red Angel, to be constructed and erected to commemorate their eternal heroism, along with the loyal sons who fell in this pointless war. With that, the Emperor's arm went limp, and he fell silent, his eye closing. So it shall be for 10,000 years hence. Perturabo and Horus fell silent and wept. Over the course of the next few weeks, the traitor forces were driven out of Segmentum Solar, giving the loyalists some well-earned breathing space. Over the course of these weeks, Perturabo had launched a crusade to hunt down and destroy all the traitors they encountered, taking a bloody toll upon those loyal to the deceased Warmaster. Horus, as the Emperor's most beloved son, had taken on duties to rule in his father's name as Lord Commander of the Imperium, and spent days at a time locked away in one of the chambers within the Imperial Palace, compiling a great tome. When he finished it, he requested for all the Loyalist commanders be summoned to the Imperial Palace, for he had an announcement to make to his brothers. Lorgar had begun to spread word of how his father, the God Emperor of mankind, had given his mortal form to save humanity from the creatures that lurk in the darkness, the beasts that would destroy their great and holy species given the chance. His greatest work, the Lutetio Divinitatis, gained a huge surge in popularity, much to his brother's chagrin. It took many days, but soon the Loyalist commanders made their way to the great audience chamber within the Imperial Palace. Perturabo of the Iron Warriors, Alpharius of the Alpha Legion, Mortarion of the Death Guard, Lorgar of the Word Bearers, Azek Araman of the Thousand Sons, Eidolon of the Emperor's Children, Khan of the World Eaters, Sevatar of the Night Lords, Aeonid Thiel of the Loyalist Ultramarines, and Bjorn of the Loyalist Wolves, now interred in the form of a hulking dreadnought. Horus Lupercal began to address them. He drafted a bill to prevent a similar event like this coup from ever occurring again, and presented it to those who gathered before him. The Codex Astartes. Horus began to explain the Codex Astartes. He reasoned that the Imperium could not risk having a single man command the power of an entire legion. The Imperium could not risk such a cataclysm from ever happening again. The legions will be broken down and restructured into chapters. Perturabo nodded solemnly, understanding the Lord Commander of the Imperium's reasoning behind his actions. Mortarion disagreed, saying that by breaking down the legions, they would be weakened, unable to defend humanity from the Xenos threats, or if ever the traitors returned. Horus allayed his fears, saying he understood his brother. Horus stated that he did not wish to do this, but regardless of his personal feelings on the matter, it was the right course of action. Mortarion relented, but remained vocal about his protests. The Lunar Wolves would be split into three chapters. The Lunar Wolves, the Sons of Horus, and the Black Templars. The Word Bearers would split, becoming the Word Bearers along with their brothers, of the Exorcists. The Death Guard would also be split in two, with the Death Guard being joined by the Dusk Raiders. The World Eaters would sire two chapters in addition to their parent World Eaters, the Devourers and the Warhounds. The Thousand Sons would have but one successor chapter, the Blood Ravens. The Iron Warriors would sire the Hammers of Terror and the Steel Serpents. The Night Lords would give rise to the Midnight Claws and the Carcharodons. The Alpha Legion would birth the Beta and Delta Legions. The Emperor's Children would give rise to the Red Scorpions and the Doom Eagles. The Loyalist Ultramarines would form their own chapter and be reborn as the Redemptionists, while the Loyalist Space Wolves would be renamed the Frost Hunters. Each chapter would go forth on a rite of conquest to find a new homeworld and build their forces until they achieved fighting strength. The Iron Warriors' homeworld would be relocated to Terra in honor of their valiant defense of the palace. Perturabo was humbled, but declined the honor. As Horus was Lord Commander of the Imperium now, it was only right for one of his chapters to become the Guardians of Terra. Horus gave the idea some thought, and agreed, naming the Black Templars the Praetorian Guard of Terra. The matter then turned to Lorgar, and his spread of the religion of the God Emperor. His brothers argued that their father was against such ideals, that his memory should not be tainted with lies. Lorgar countered, however, the Emperor was a sign of hope for the people, of humanity as a whole. The people of the Imperium had witnessed the greatest war in humanity's history since the Age of Strife. They needed an icon of hope, lest they fall back into anarchy and brutality. And faith in the God Emperor provided this hope. Ever the skilled orator, Lorgar persuaded his brothers to allow him to set up the cult of the Emperor as an official state religion to bring unity to mankind under their father's golden light, founding what would become known as the Ecclesiarchy. And thus, the heresy came to an end, and mankind took its first steps towards an uncertain future, without the Emperor to ever walk amongst them again. 10,000 years have passed since the Great Heresy. Mankind suffers from onslaughts from its many enemies, the traitor legions, demons, and a multitude of aggressive and dangerous Xenos species. The loyal Primarchs who survived the Heresy have long since vanished, either dead or disappeared into the unknown without a trace. Upon Terra, the Emperor sits upon the Golden Throne, his undying yet decaying flesh forever linked to it. He has remained silent for millennia, and more than ever, the people need his guiding light. His bodyguards, the Legio Custodes, continue their eternal vigilance over their fallen master. For the first time in centuries, the main doors to the throne room creaked open, dust spilling from the carved nooks and crannies of its exquisite design. A pair of strangers, giants of men, slowly entered. One clad in an ornate and ancient set of heresy patterned power armor, carrying a great double-handed power sword, a melter weapon built into the hilt. The other, in an equally ancient set of cataphracty patterned terminator armor, wielding a pair of ornate lightning claws with wrist-mounted combi bolters. All traces of the Imperial Aquila had long been removed from the armor. as the strangers slowly approached the golden throne. They activated their weapons, sending crackling arcs of lightning from their blades. The custodians took up a combat stance and demanded them to stand down and be executed for this heresy. The strangers remained silent as they approached, and the custodians moved to attack. Their movements were blindingly fast despite their sheer size, their movements blocking the strikes of the custodians' guardian spears before countering with their own blades, stabbing, slashing, disemboweling and decapitating all who dared stand in their way. Soon, all the custodians lay dead on the floor, and the Captain General, Constantine Valdor, himself lay against the very foot of the golden throne, his innards spilling out over the reflective floor and feeling the very life ebb away from his body. As he looked up in pain at the strangers, he asked one last question. "Who are you?" The power-armored stranger sheathed his blade and removed his helm with a hiss of pressurized air. The Captain General of the Custodians looked on in sheer horror at the sight before him. This stranger had raven black hair, piercing red eyes, and skin like marble. But in all other regards, he looked almost identical to the Emperor himself when he walked amongst mortal men. The stranger then spoke. "We are the lost and the purged, and we have come to reclaim what is rightfully ours."